hand.
And you were with Washington Falcons took flight for the first time last week against Lamar, and what a debut. A ball game that came right down to the last play of the game when a two-point conversion was knocked away to preserve a one-point win. Now the Falcons must face the quick-strike offense of Hartsville, led by quarterback Travis Coe. The Red Foxes also won their opener convincingly over Hillcrest. It's Hartsville and Darlington in our high school football game of the week. Welcome to Kellytown Stadium, where an established tradition-rich program goes up against one that is just beginning. Good evening, everyone. I'm Terry Gern, along with Lane Harris. Thanks for joining us for the TV 21 Game of the Week. Opposite ends of the spectrum here as Hartsville takes on Darlington.
Lewis Leinberger's Red Foxes are here every year, and they've done it because they've got a superior weight training program and a great feeder program from the JVs. They've always got good athletes.
The Darlington defense will be pressed into action tonight in stopping one Travis Coe.
Travis Coe's very quick on the corner, only 5'4", but explosive on the offensive end.
Real exciting player, a battle of two top 10 teams here tonight. From Kellytown Stadium, we'll have the kickoff live and exclusively here on WWMB.
Good credit, bad credit, we can help at Rent-A-Center, the largest rent-to-own center in the world, where you can rent name-brand appliances, name-brand furniture, big-screen TVs, VCRs, and more, all at low weekly or monthly rates. With no down payment, we'll even deliver it to you for free. Rent real diamond and gold bridal jewelry with no credit check and no deposit. We're also the only company in town that rents pagers. If you need it, come to Rent-A-Center for no hassles and great service. Located in the Hallmark Shopping Center on South Irby Street in Florence.
At Sunoco, people make the difference. More than 2,000 team members in South Carolina. Committed to generating customer satisfaction through excellence. Committed to using their talents and skills to enhance the quality of life in our communities. Committed to making a difference. Sunoco, proud to call South Carolina home. In the spirit of working together, building a better South Carolina. Sunoco.
You're watching WWMB TV 21, Florence, Myrtle Beach.
Welcome back to Hartsville. Darlington has won the toss. They will receive. As we are set to get underway, Chris Jones has it teed. This should be a good one, folks. Couple of top 10 teams in the coaches' poll. Both teams won their openers. 1-0 against 1-0. Nice crowd out hand, too, here at Hartsville, as always.
Yes, back deep for Falcons. Travis, Rashawn Travis is a major college prospect in the words of his coach. Very excited about him.
And they kick it away from Travis. The ball is caught there by Tracy Burns. Burns has got a little bit of a seam up the middle, and Burns is out across the 30, but the ball is on the floor, on the ground, and Hartsville comes up with it. No. Overruled. The ball squirts out of there at the last moment, and the referee is saying that Darlington retains possession. A little bit of confusion down there. Now the other referee says no. Hartsville has the football.
Well, Lewis Leinberger was waiting for the officials to make the call. He had his offensive team over on the side of the field. And all the guys on the kickoff team were in jubilation, so they knew they had the ball.
So Hartsville gets the first big break of this ball game. They will start first and 10 from inside the Darlington 40-yard line. We'll call it the 37. First and 10, and our first look at number 11, Travis Coe. And there he is, the quickness. Coe up the middle, reverse pivot, gets to the 30, is forward progress. Nice gain of about 6 yards.
There you see that quickness. As soon as he comes up from under center, he's going to attract a lot of attention from the defensive end and the secondary tonight.
One exciting, explosive quarterback. Let's check out the Hartsville offense now. There's Coe at quarterback. Behind him, Corey Jordan and Terry McPhail, the tailback. Leon Brown, Chucky Moore, Chad Hope, Bernard Dixon, Jacobia Arnold, the front line up front. All seniors except for Moore. Uton, Jacobs, and Kosum are the receivers. And there's Coe again. The pitch this time to McPhail. McPhail breaks the tackle. He's inside the 20, taken down at around the 16-yard line.
Nice read that time by Coe, the quarterback. The Darlington defense did a real good job of stringing that play out, but Coe just made the right decision with the pitch to McPhail.
Well, this is the Red Fox offense at its best, Lane. Quickness, that option. You've better gone to school during the week to prepare for this team.
They really do a good job up front. They're down linemen, Dixon, Hope, and Moore. They got real good strength at the guard position. That's where they're going to run behind a lot.
First and 10 for Hartsville. The give goes to McPhail. He's got blocking. Cut back across the 10. He gets down to about the 8, and they're just ripping off the yardage now, chunk by chunk. Nice little drive here put together by the Red Foxes coming off that kickoff fumble.
Nice little trap play off the guard position. Good run upside in the hole. Coach Harris on the other side of the ball asked him tonight, what are you going to have to do defensively to have a chance in this game? And he looked right in the eye and said, we're going to have to pray. I mean, they are just so tough. Offensively, they do a great job of controlling the ball.
Second and 3 from the 9. Coe taking his time behind the line of scrimmage. The option once again. Coe keeps it himself, and he takes it down to the 3-yard line. Close to a first down. Actually, he does indeed get that first down, so it'll be first and goal from just inside the 5 for Hartsville. What a way to start this ball game.
This Red Fox crowd, as we came out right before the kickoff, right before we came on the air, really got up on their feet and started making a lot of noise, and they were beckoned by the Red Foxes on the field to get up, and it got them going early. A nice little run back that time by Travis, had a nice hole, but put the ball on the ground, and team's going
to
pay.
I formation, pitch goes to McPhail, cut back, he's in there. Touchdown, Hartsville. So the Red Foxes take advantage of the first turnover of the ball game. They turn it into a clinic. A beautiful drive capped off by this run from Terry McPhail.
Nice little cut back there. Just a little tall sweep. He waits and bides his time and cuts back inside the linebacker for the score.
Chris Jones to tack on the extra point. Very solid kicker. And he's money in the bank there. Goes right up on our camera platform. 7-0, Hartsville. That quick strike offense living up to its reputation. They go on top of Darlington with 9:05 to play in the first quarter, 7-0.
There's a good look at that Kellytown crowd. These folks come out strong every night, win, lose, or draw for this team. Great backing. It's almost like a college program in the atmosphere at the football game here. They come through the tunnel a la Gamecocks with the 2001 theme and really do it upright, a tribute to their fans.
Let's keep in mind now that Hartsville is coming into this game as the second-ranked team in the coaches poll. They're with a battle with Dillon. They think they should be number one. Dillon's on top right now at number one. Two very good ball clubs. But Hartsville's coming off that win over Hillcrest, the game they play on Sunday. They've only had 4 days to prepare here, Lane.
It hurts both teams, because Darlington at the same – they don't get film until Monday to start preparing for Hartsville.
Good point,
so it
kind
of works both ways. But Coach Limeberger was concerned that he would not have enough time to rest his players properly and get them prepared. So they probably did a lot of late-night studying of film and preparing and getting the kids really a crash course in preparing for Darlington. Right now, we haven't seen the Darlington offense, but it looks like it's paying off.
Well, here's Tracy Burns again. Let's see if he can hold on to the football as he goes out across the 25, and he's stacked up there by a host of Red Fox defenders. Let's take a look at that scoring drive, and what an impressive one it was. 6 plays, 36 yards. They did it quickly, just under 3 minutes. The McPhail touchdown, and Hartsville leads 7-0. So Darlington will give it their best shot. Nice shot there of Lewis Leinberger on the sidelines. This guy's a tactician, and you'll never find a Hartsville team that isn't prepared for a ball game. They go into every game ready to play. Orlando Hudson, number one, the quarterback for the Darlington Falcons under center. Looks like he may be checking off. The quick flip to the outside goes to number two, Rashawn Travis. Nice little play there. I like the call on that play, Lane. They just flip it out. He saw something, and he got it to the receiver.
The athleticism of this Hartsville defense, which everyone knows, will really be tested tonight. Hudson and Rashawn Travis are going to do a great job of hooking up. The other receiver on the other side of the ball, number 14, Brian Scott, 6'3", 185. Both of these receivers really scare Lewis Leinberger.
High formation behind Hudson. Second and five. The quick toss. Looked like someone may have hit Houston's arm. The ball falls incomplete. That'll bring up third and four.
That was the throw that time, number 14, Brian Scott, as he was back in the huddle. Looked like, to my observation, Orlando Hudson hit his hand on the helmet of his fullback. The back split in the out formation, and Orlando, after he threw that pass, was really shaking his hand hard. Terry, we need to point out Travis Burns, who started last week for Darlington, will not play tonight. Bad ankle. Casey Samuel will start at the tailback position. He's a 5'9", 170-pound junior.
That's right. Big blow to Darlington. Another checkoff here by Orlando Houston. Big play here for Darlington. They don't want to go three and out. Houston back to pass. Pump fake. He avoids the sack for the time being, but then gets swarmed under. Number 87, Sean Smith, is there for Hartsville. He brings him down. He gets the sack.
Hudson, to his defense, had a hard time last week against Lamar. He's having a hard time adjusting this new line. You gotta realize, these folks haven't played together for 3 years.
Yeah.
All these kids have just been thrown together in the past year. They've got to learn how to play against each other. Good up front rush. The linemen for Hartsville really contained themselves in their lanes, and it made it hard for Hudson to scramble and get out of the pocket.
That's right. This is the Mayo-St. John's merger, and this is only game two. They eked out that win last week against Lamar. What a ball game at the end of the game. A high-hanging punt, and this is Coe, the quarterback. Travis, actually, it's McPhail at the 30, and he dances around it. He'll be taken down there at the 31. Nice coverage that time by Darlington on a high hanger. That's the kind you return.
Yeah, Hudson's going to be one of the better punters in the state. That just goes to show you some of the athletic ability of this young man. He can stand back in the pocket, sling it downfield for big yardage, run the option. And he can also, when he gets in trouble, he can drop back on fourth down and make the big kick. Also, if he goes into the shotgun, you got to look for the quick kick.
See the quarterback as the punter on a lot of teams. Best athlete on the team in most cases. And certainly Orlando Hudson is a wonderful athlete. I formation, quick pitch, McPhail. But this time, the Darlington defense is ready. Marginal gain, we'll call it a gain of one. That'll bring up second and nine for Hartsville. They only threw the ball four times last week, Lane, but all four were completed, and one of them went for a touchdown. So they don't throw much, but when they do, they're pretty effective.
Well, that shows you what they have confidence in. But Coach Leinberger was very impressed with the way Coe threw the ball when he threw it. Only four passes, as you said, but when he threw it, he was on target, and he hit his receivers. He scored a touchdown after a turnover against Dalzell late in the first half on a beautiful 20-yard touchdown pass. So he's got the tools.
Another reverse pivot by Coe, and the pitch to McPhail. Beautiful play that time by number nine, Jimmy Bell of Darlington. Just came up from his linebacker position. That's a perfect way to play that option.
A lot of youngsters playing on the Darlington defensive side of the ball. Jimmy Bell, a perfect example, a 5'10", 194-pound sophomore. Just comes up and gets enough of a body on McPhail to knock him off his feet. You see in the background of that picture, two Darlington defenders occupying Travis Coe. Mm-hmm. If that Hartsville can get that mismatch all night, there's going to be some long runs broken by the tailback
right.
And fullback.
Just a matter of time before McPhail breaks it open. Good job of containment that time, though, by Darlington, Jimmy Bell. There's Coe's first pass. He gets it in there complete. A beautiful pass. There you see the nice spiral that Travis Coe can throw. And Clint Jacobs, recipient of the touchdown last week against Hillcrest, hauls in the reception. Good gain, but not quite good enough for the first down. That'll bring up fourth down, so Hartsville's going to have to punt it away.
And it's amazing how a guy only 5'4 can get enough of the hand around the ball to throw a good spiral like that.
Yeah, I was wondering when we were going to bring that up. 5'4 is Travis Coe. Bad snap for Jason Dawkins, who just gets the punt off. taken there by Brantley. Jett avoids one tackler, still on his feet. Dancing around there by the 35. He gets it across to about the 36-yard line where the Falcons will take over second possession of the game. 5:15 remaining in the first quarter. Let's check out the Darlington offense led by Orlando Hudson at quarterback. Mustafa Stanley and Burns, as we said, out of the game. Casey Samuels is in his stead. Patterson, Weatherford, Ladrone Coe, Jody Padgett, George Beasley across the front. Don DeBose, your tight end. Scott and Rashawn Travis, the receivers. I formation for Hudson. Keeps it himself. Not much running room. Gets a couple of yards, though, out to the 40-yard line.
Boy, he picked up a nice block that time on the option by Brian Scott. Brian was out on the wide out and broke down against the cornerback, and the cornerback never came up to four, so all Brian did was turn around and pick off one of the pursuers of Hudson.
Let's check out that Hartsville defense now. Up front, Sean Smith, Terry Frazier, Terrell Cherry, Frazier, and Sean Smith. Cecil Jackson, Wilson, the linebackers, and there you see the backs, Lawson, Jacobs, Scott, and Williams. Second and five for the Falcons, right at the 40-yard line. Here's Hudson to throw. Plenty of time. Great blocking by the Falcons. Hudson trying to find time. He throws across the field. He's got a man. The ball is complete. The number 31, Don DeBose, his tight end. What an athletic play by Orlando Hudson. Man, he delivered that thing nicely. I believe there is a penalty on the play, and that thing could be coming back. But what a play, Lane. What a throw.
This is what Gerald Henderson needs. He needs this young offensive line to give this young man a chance to showcase his skills. And he waits, and the middle of the field opens wide open for the receiver.
Wow.
Nice catch. Unfortunately, it's going to come back because the penalty flag is in the line of scrimmage, probably a legal procedure.
Folks, I'm not sure if you realize, and that's exactly what we've got here against Darlington. They're going to push him back. I don't think many people realize how difficult a throw that is. You've got a right-handed quarterback rolling to his left and throwing against the grain down the middle, and he threw that all arm. That thing traveled a good 40 yards in the air on a rope.
He's got the skills. He's got the body. 6'1", 170 pounds. You see him in there right now, you know, trying to keep the guy's spirits up. A couple of linemen after that penalty were kind of showing some disgust. That's a good move by Orlando. The senior leadership, he's getting his kids together in the huddle and going to keep them together because, you know, this is an up-and-coming program. They have some great talent. The Darlington St. John's school last year beat Hartsville 3-2. They had some good, talented people coming back. Limeburger knows that. Harrison knows that. It's just a matter of time before these guys. They had a great win last week on a great defensive play on a two-point conversion the last part of the game. They've got the skills. They've got the talent. Be patient. This is the game that can put them on the map.
Well, when you put two schools together, inevitably you're going to get some talent. Quick toss. It is caught there by Travis. He gets it out to about the 35-yard line, right about to the original line of scrimmage. Actually, they're going to mark it at the 32. He stepped out of bounds. And that's going to bring up fourth down. So a big offensive play negated for Darlington, and they've got to get past that.
Brad Lawson and Marcus Scott are the cornerbacks for Hartsville. Both of those guys are going to need to get a lot of help from the free safety and the strong safety, Williams and Jacobs, for the Hartsville pass defense to be effective. Because as we see, Hudson's going to go get the ball in Travis's hands as quick and as often as he can to try to highlight this young man's speed. It's 4-4.
Another boomer by Hudson. Coe is underneath it. He grabs it, goes to his left.
Oh,
look at the speedy Coe. He's going to try to find an alley to the left side. Turns the corner. Travis Coe still on his feet. Out to the 45-yard line. And, man, is this kid exciting.
Well, he put a move on a Darlington defender that made him go down to his knees. He was begging for mercy on it. I think it was number 40 for Darlington. That's Antonio Mills, but he laid him down. Nice little drop step, dropped the hip. And as soon as the guy went for the fake, Travis turns it on outside, and the guy just went to his knees.
Well, Hudson has certainly given the hang time there for his punt team to cover it. They better cover it with Cohen McPhail back there. Two dangerous return men. Hartsville, once again, out of the I formation. And the handoff goes to McPhail, following his blocking off the left side. He's taken down there after a gain of about 2 yards.
Something we saw on that punt play in the first series of downs for Hartsville. The Darlington defense is not doing a real good job of tackling. They're getting a lot of contact on the ball player, on the running backs, the line of scrimmage. But a running back like McPhail and a quarterback like Coe, you better wrap these guys up and put them down because they've got the strength from that weight conditioning we talked about to break tackles and make long games.
Corey King initially in on that play defensively for Darlington. He gets credit with the tackle. Receivers split to both sides. I formation for Coe. Play action. Looking for that quick look, and he tucks in and runs. And look out, Travis Coe is on the move again. Dragged down from behind by Aubrey McKay, but not before Travis Coe comes up with another big gainer. Takes it inside the 30-yard line. Look at this kid.
He just stands up looking for a slant pattern from the wide receiver. Both defensive backs crashed on him, and he ducked the ball right up through the tackle hole and turns on the burners.
What a heady play, almost like a basketball pick. Your receiver is working with you. You take it to the outside. Good heady play at that time by Coe.
The first series for Darlington, Terry, they lined up in a 4-4, a split four defense. Now we see them in a 5-3 look. They're trying to shut down the run for Hartsville.
Well, yeah, they absolutely have to do that. Put some guys up front. And a little, looked like Coe wanted to hand it off to his fullback, Corey Jordan. But
I think Coe wanted to get it back.
Yeah, exactly. Give it back. That is so important. It's a tough play to run. If you have a quarterback that can utilize that option and can run it to perfection, man, you can drive a defense just crazy all night, all afternoon. Stick it in, pull it out, pitch it.
What we saw that time for the Darlington defense, if their defensive end sits there and waits for Travis Coe to come, they're going to be able to eat him alive. Well, I think the Darlington defensive ends are going to start doing is start pinching down. As soon as they see the option coming, come down and either take the fullback or the quarterback out of the play and let your cornerbacks come and clean up on the option pitch. Now we see the Darlington defense starting to come to life. Number 40 in there, Antonio Mills from the linebacker position.
Thing we got to keep in mind, too, Lane, is that when they start focusing in on that option so much and start pinching in on the inside and in on the tackles, that's when Hartsville's going to come back with the play action and the passing game and start trying to pop McPhail to the outside. So you shut one thing down, you got to worry about another thing. Pick your poison when you play this Red Fox team. They are certainly a potent offense.
Double tight end set.
Third and eight. Straight drop for Coe. He's got him. Oh, and the ball is dropped. He had his receiver, Clint Jacobs. That was almost too catchable. And Jacobs, I think, maybe was thinking six.
Clint did a little hop right before he tried to catch this ball, and I think it threw him off. Watch him kind of jump up in the air to make the catch. The ball was not thrown too high, but that little hitch in his jump kicked the ball out when he came back down.
Well, let me tell you, he had a seam to the outside. He had a blocker there, and he could have gone to pay dirt had he made that catch. Well, we're having a good time here in Hartsville, and the hometown team is certainly enjoying this one. They lead it 7-0 with 1:50 to go in the first quarter. Back after this.
Something happens when you read the Wall Street Journal every business day. You start seeing opportunities where you never saw them before. See for yourself. Subscribe now to the Wall Street Journal. The Journal keeps you right at the heart of what's going on in business. Call now for the Journal and get your free guide to planning your financial future. Facts you need to start planning a secure future right now. Get 10 weeks of the Wall Street Journal for just $38 and get the guide free. Call now toll free. 800-334-2900. That's 800-334-2900.
This is your brain when you're sleeping. This is your brain in English class, because this is what you're thinking about. No wonder you're thirsty.
This is WWMB TV 21, Florence Myrtle Beach.
Welcome back to Hartsville. Terry Gern along with Lane Harris. Hope you are enjoying our installment of the Game of the Week. From Hartsville, the Red Foxes leading the Falcons of Darlington 7-0. Fourth down for Hartsville at the Darlington 27-yard line. It is fourth and nine, and they are going for it. Yeah, and there's the veteran Coe. You got a senior quarterback, stutter that cadence, get 5 yards.
There's a way to pick up five quick ones right there. The young Darlington offensive line, you got Antonio Rouse, a junior, Antonio Gardner, a junior, Draper Samuel and Corey King, a couple of seniors at the defensive end position. They bring in Antonio Mills, number 40, to fill out the defensive line when they go to the 5-3. They got to tighten up now. You got to open up some options with fourth and four now.
Fourth and four indeed. inside the 20-yard line. Coe with the pitch.
Look at
Darlington there. Is there. They sniff it out. And Jimmy Bell, his second big defensive play of the night. He's just all over that play.
All last week for Coach Harrison's team, the defense was tentative. The kids were very anxious playing their first game with a new high school, and they just barely eked out a win versus Lamar. Looks like the same thing in this game, going up against the perennial power of Hartsville. Kids are a little bit nervous. They seem to be getting their wind back under them, their feet under them. They're remembering their techniques, and they're starting to execute.
Well, hand it to the Falcons after the missed opportunity on the penalty after that long pass play. They make Hartsville turn it over on downs, and Hudson's going for the big bomb. Wow, does this kid have an arm? That thing just traveled 65 yards in the air.
You want pro style? Here's pro style for you. Splits two wideouts out, one to the bottom of the screen, cranks it to his low receiver. He's not going there, folks. He's going high and tight to the wide side of the field, and he's got too much arm for this play. He overthrows everybody. But look at that, good throw away from the defender. The defender has no chance to catch that ball if his receiver is a little bit faster, which I don't know how you can ask him to be a little bit faster. He runs a 4.440 on the outside for Travis, gracious sakes.
Not too many quarterbacks out throw Rashawn Travis, but Hudson with a cannon that time. Pro set offense once again, pump fake by Hudson, he's on the move. Oh, I don't know how he got out of that one, just throws it away. Heady play, but they're going to flag him for it. Looks like intentional grounding, trying to avoid that sack, and the laundry comes out. Tough break for Darlington.
It's tough when you're a 17-year-old to make the type of decisions that the pros and the college players make on the field. He's definitely in trouble right here. He's looking for somebody to hit. At this point, instead of throwing the ball wide on the sidelines, throw it straight down the sidelines or just inside of it, and you may be able to save that call because he did have number 14, Brian Scott, on the sideline.
Yeah, you're right.
If you throw that ball down the sideline, the official has to give you the benefit of the doubt.
Right.
But as it is now, it's really going to knock him out. It's going to be a loss of down. It's going to put him in a third and real long.
Well, that's been the story thus far for Darlington. They have been able to come up with a couple of big plays here and there, but they followed up with a not-so-good play, a play that hurts them, reminiscent of our first game of the week, what Mullins did against Marion. Third and 29, Darlington calls a timeout. Didn't like the play they had called, apparently. Going to talk things over here.
Here's Gerald Harrison.
Coach Harrison coming out.
He's going to call his offensive unit over to talk about this one.
Gerald Harrison, the coach of Mayo last season. I'll bring everyone over to the sidelines to chat about this one.
He's talking with the officials, I think, about the last play. Or he's getting on to them about something over there. And he's pointing to the middle of the field, completely away from the play. I think what he's talking about is that he had a receiver.
Yeah.
He had Brian Scott over on the sidelines, and how can the official throw a grounding call? Well, if you'd have been over on this side of the field, Coach Harrison, unfortunately, you see that the ball landed on the track about 15 to 20 yards away from the sideline.
Yeah, I'm always curious about this call because when I was playing, it was always told, throw it to your mother in the third row. You know,
right.
Just get rid of it. In the pros, obviously, if you're trying to avoid the sack, it's intentional grounding. At the high school level, apparently the same holds true.
Well, Miss Hudson would have been open for that one because it was way out to the right hand side of the track. Coach Harrison didn't seem to agree with that. He's had his piece with the officials, but I don't think it's going to change anybody's mind. Orlando was definitely in trouble. Had nobody short to throw to, and was definitely throwing the ball high and away.
Can't fault Hudson for trying to avoid that big loss.
But almost you can almost just try to find an open spot in the field and throw it into the turf. You know, but there's a lot of, like I said, that decision is very tough for a 17-year-old to make sometimes.
Well, third and 28, they better hurry. Hudson looking for another big bomb. He's got a man, but overthrows once again. And once again, it's Rashawn Travis out there. There was a little bit of contact. Travis wanted the call, but he's not going to get it because that ball really was not catchable. But Hudson's pumping once before he throws it. Maybe he should pump twice and let the receiver get down there.
Give him just a little more time, Big O. I tell you, that might have been a good position right there to go into the shotgun. Let quick kick one. You're deep in a hole.
Well,
they know you're going to throw the ball. Well, that might have been a good move there.
You know, there was a little bit of confusion as they were setting up, and I thought maybe they were going to quick kick that one. The play clock was starting to run down on them there. We have 58 seconds remaining here in the first quarter, and now Hudson will drop back in punt formation. Cohen McPhail stand at midfield. Hartsville's going to come up with some good field position here. Another high hanger. Coe is underneath it. No fair catch. The signal takes it at the 47. Takes it down the sideline. Spins and steps out at the Darlington 38-yard line. And that's where Hartsville will take over with 47 seconds remaining now in the first quarter.
Hartsville special teams are doing a real good job of chucking the Darlington defenders at the line of scrimmage, because I think Lineberger knows Orlando Hudson's going to get off high, long punts. And if you can chuck those linemen, keep them from getting downfield to get on to Coe. And matter of fact, even when they do get down there, they're not fast enough to stick to Coe.
Yep, all he needs is a seam. First and 10 for the Foxes. There you see all those bugs on the field. They are all over the place here. Coe following both of his backs in a shoestring tackle that time. Saves what could have been a big, big gainer. Coe gains about 7 on the play.
Antonio Mills, number 40 again, making the play. He's really been on a lot of action. Antonio's playing the nose guard position for Darlington. So they brought in Mills to play the nose guard and took out a linebacker in the 5-3 to play the 5-3. They're still in the 5-3 right now.
Second and 5 for Coe. The hand is given to Tim Coe, and there's really nowhere to run for Timmy as he gets stacked up there.
Timmy got a lot of action last week versus Hillcrest of Dalzell. Had 8 carries for 20 yards. He's a 5'11", 182-pound sophomore. And he can't be any kin to Travis, good gracious. Right?
Huh?
He can't be any kin to Travis. I mean, he's 5'11". Travis is only 5'4".
No, can't be.
Can't be.
Well, sometimes you get that mutant gene in there somewhere, and it just you get a big kid out of there. But that is the end of the first quarter. A good one for Hartsville. They lead Darlington 7-0.
The forces of evil can strike anytime.
Destroy Nemo and the Nautilus.
The forces of evil can strike anywhere.
Fire, you fools!
Soon, the forces of good will strike back.
We're going to full power.
Kids, watch Space Strikers with your free 3D vision glasses. Available September 1st at your local Sonic Drive-In restaurant. Sonic Drive-In for a change.
Sunoco. 17,000 team members around the world. Safety-minded. Smart-thinking. Hard-working. Quality conscious. Talent sharing. The Sunoco team. Committed to making a difference. Sunoco. Proud to call South Carolina home. In the spirit of working together, building a better South Carolina.
Name is Kramer.
You're not normal.
What do you say about a guy like this, huh?
His buttocks are sublime.
Said I was a hipster doofus.
Can't you see I'm burned out?
My boys need a house.
Yo, yo, ma.
I'm Kramer.
5 times a week.
Oh, baby.
Coming this fall to TV 21. You are watching WWMB TV 21, Florence, Myrtle Beach.
We are back live in Hartsville, where it is 3rd and 5, and the pitch goes to Tim Coe. He gets the first down, and yes, Tim is the brother of Travis Coe. Travis is a senior. Tim is only a sophomore, but Tim better not pick on Travis.
Just give him the ball,
Travis,
big brother.
Travis better not pick on Tim, because he's a little bigger and he's going to grow, probably.
He said, just pitch me the ball, number 11. I'll show you how to pick it up. Nice play that time by the Coe brothers.
Very good pickup. 1st and 10. Ball is spotted at the 27-yard line of Darlington. So once again, Hartsville has got a decent drive going here, chewing up a lot of the clock. Once again, that I formation lined up behind Coe. Option. Coe's got the ball around the right side. He's got a seam, puts his head down. Travis Coe burying his way down to the 15-yard line. Flag on the play. Let's check this one out.
It's a very late flag, too, yeah. Jerry. Coe at 5'4 really stuck his head down. What we're seeing, looks like it's going to be a clip. It's going to come back. The Darlington defensive ends are really getting caught up a little bit too much in the fullback dive, because when that defensive end bites on that dive play, Coe's going to have all day around the corner.
Let's take a look at those first quarter stats now. First downs for Darlington, a big goose egg, couple for Hartsville. Rushing yards, you see the huge difference there. Hartsville with only one pass, they completed for 6 yards. Turnovers, that was a big one for Darlington because Hartsville converted it into a touchdown. And look at that time of possession.
That's the wow. That opening Hartsville drive really ate a lot of clock, and Darlington's offense has really been able to muster nothing as of yet.
Well, here we go. It's now first and 20 for Hartsville from the Darlington 25-yard line. Interesting situation here for the Red Foxes. Coe under center. He's looking to pass. Coe firing down the middle, and the ball this time is caught. Touchdown, Hartsville. Number 82, Clint Jacob, hauls in his second touchdown pass of the season.
The backs
moved. He fouled it for a minute, but he hauls it in.
Nice play that time. Nice camera work by the guys in the field. Nice little sweep action. All Travis did was pull up and hit his tight end just slanting across the middle. Again, poor tackling by the Darlington secondary. These guys have got to wrap it up, put the guys on the ground. You make a tackle there, Hartsville still outside the goal line.
Clint Jacobs, a big target for Coe to hit. The kick is up and good by Chris Jones. And just like that, Hartsville goes up by 2 touchdowns. And there's your hero thus far, Travis Coe, 14-0. Hartsville.
Join WMB TV 21 and Mix 97.7 every Saturday afternoon at Wild Water and Wheels in Myrtle Beach for the Tato Wild Dance Party. It's going to be a slip, slide summer of fun at Wild Water and Wheels every Saturday afternoon from noon until 2 for the Tato Wild Dance Party. Come dance the afternoon away at Wild Water and Wheels, the Tato Wild Dance Party on WMB TV 21.
She don't know she messing with.
Here's your chance to see the show that everyone's been talking about. Gullah Productions presents A Joyful Sound, backed by overwhelming demand for 2 big shows, September 2nd and 3rd, Saturday at 7 p.m. and Sunday at 6 p.m. at the Myrtle Beach High School Auditorium. It's the show the Sun News calls a welcome addition to the Myrtle Beach area. Get your tickets now at these locations or charge by phone at 448-4566. A Joyful Sound. If you've seen it once, you've got to see it again.
For Fun and Sun, WMB TV 21 brings you live high school football. Friday, September 8th, it's the Battle of the Border when the Marlboro County Bulldogs take on the Scotland County Fighting Scots. For live high school football, you watch WMB TV 21.
You're watching WWMB TV 21, Florence, Myrtle Beach.
Non-conference games is establish some running programs so that when they get into their region play, they've got a much more balanced attack. What we're seeing them do tonight, though, is they're coming out firing.
Not a bad idea. Great move right there by Brian Scott as he makes the reception. A very nice first down play by Darlington, and that is something they need, a spark. And that is their first down of the game.
Don't force it, Orlando. Give what the defense, take what the defense gives you. That time the corner was playing off too far. A nice little spot up that time by number 14, Brian Scott. Puts a nice little move. Number 24 for Harsh will take a seat. Brad Lawson.
Another pass. Oh, would have been a great catch right there by Rashawn Travis. Tried to make a one-hander there. Let's check out that Hartsville scoring drive once again. It's a quick one. In 2 minutes, they go 5 plays, and they cover 30 yards. The touchdown pass, a 35-yard strike to Clint Jacobs, 14-0. The home team on top of the Falcons. Second and 10 from the 43 of Darlington. Orlando Hudson taking his time, checking things off here at the line of scrimmage. Hudson wants to throw. He's got time, and he's got a man, but he's overthrown him consistently here now, Lane, by 6 yards, 6-7 yards.
That's just his, you know, the Hartsville's got to give the Hartsville's defensive front credit there, because what they're doing is they're getting up in his face, and he's feeling that pressure and just firing the trigger a little too early. His receivers are running good routes. They're getting single coverage on the outside, yep. So it's just a matter of time before he can hook up one. But a lot of things have to happen. It's not just you drop back in the pocket and throw it to the wide open receiver. That's what defense is there for, and Hartsville defense is one of the best in the state.
Tough situation now for the Falcons after a quick first down. They are looking at third and 10 now. Here is Hudson. He's got a man, but just misses. Trying to squeeze it in there to Don DeBose, his tight end. DeBose, the recipient of that long pass we saw in the first quarter that was brought back because of a penalty. DeBose wasn't able to stretch out for that one.
DeBose was wide open that time, yep. Because Hartsville blitzed both them inside linebackers. The linebackers would have picked up DeBose. So Orlando rolls out of the pocket, looks at and sees the receiver wide up in the field. You got to hook up on those, though.
Well, one thing that is vulnerable when you play that 5-2 defense is the seams down the middle. And if Darlington can expose that, they may have something to work with. McPhail and Coe are looking at this punt. They're going to let it go wisely. Takes a Darlington roll, and it'll be downed at the 11-yard line, actually the 16-yard line of Hartsville. But Hartsville will take over here in the second quarter with 9:34 remaining. They got a 2-touchdown lead. And this team is one of those teams that can chew some clock.
You know, what have we seen from Darlington so far? 3 plays and out every time. Have they even had a running play yet? I don't think so. 2 running plays, excuse me.
Wow.
Hartsville's thrown the ball 10 times. They've had 2 running plays, 4 series, 3 plays
apiece.
Wow,
I didn't even realize that. That's just amazing statistic, 2 running plays. And not going to do it for you, not against this team. You got to be able to mix it up. First and 10 for the Red Foxes. Here's Coe. The handoff up the middle. McPhail trying to get some room. And he'll pick up about 2 yards on the play, bring up 2nd and 8. Gets it to the 20-yard line.
I'm going to try to pick it up on this next play, but it looks like Darlington's changed defenses again. They may be even going with a 6-man front now, trying to throw a few more bodies up there to take away that option for Coe.
Lewis Leinberger, one of the best coaches in the PD region, and looks like he's got himself a good team this year, great team this year. That tradition is coming on, coming back very, very strong. Number 2 team in the coaches' poll, Hartsville Red Foxes.
Number 61 for Darlington, Antonio Rouse, is limping off the sidelines. Doesn't seem to, hopefully won't be too serious an injury, maybe just an ankle sprain or maybe even a cramp. It is another hot, humid night. Yeah. Here tonight for high school football.
Going to see that for the first few weeks of the season. We saw a lot of cramping.
Darlington's still
a lot of teams in that first week.
Darlington's still in the 5-3, Terry.
Coe with the hand to McPhail. Great running by McPhail. Still on his feet trying to back in there. Gets it out across the 25-yard line. Jelani Sly comes up from his safety position to make the hit. Forward progress will bring it to about the 25-yard line, so it's going to be 3rd and very, very short. 3rd and a long 1 for Hartsville.
It looks like Hartsville's version of the counter tray there. All the linemen block down. They pull 2 guards and lead for the tailback coming through there. So you got 2 guards, fullback leading for your tailback on that play. That's one of Hartsville's bread and butters.
So a big play here for Hartsville. 3rd and 1. And McPhail gets the first down, just plowing his way up the middle. He needed 1, he got 2.
Mills and Page, Mills the nose guard, Page the inside linebacker, did a good job of stopping that play. They stood Chet Hope, the center, up on that play, and the fullback ran right into his back. And it looks like they might have had a chance to stop that play on 3rd and short, with a good strong running ahead by the running back, got the first down.
1st and 10 for Hartsville. They're doing it again.
Chewing on some clock.
Very efficient offense. McPhail, 35 yards on the night, 9 carries. Gets the call that time, and Darlington this time is there to make the stop. Gain of maybe 1 yard. That's about it.
K Taco that time looked like he was going to duck upfield and run, and the tailback ran right into him. In the game now for the Hartsville Red Fox, number 83, Charlie Bradshaw, one of the end positions. Charlie's a 6'3", 193-pound junior. In the offensive line, I thought I saw a change in the offensive line. Everybody seems to be attacked, mostly starters in the offensive line.
All seniors up front for Hartsville, except for Chucky Moore, who is a junior. The hand to McPhail, he's got a seam. McPhail fumbles the football, and it is free. Tracy Burns, number 20 for Darlington, comes up with it, and a much-needed break, Lane Harris,
that gets them in good
for
field,
the Falcons.
Gets them in good field position. Their defense gets a chance to rest. Their offense has got to be learning something. Nice run this time from McPhail. Just in his effort to pick up that extra yard, the ball almost seemed to squirt out when he hit the ground. You know, I don't know if the ground could cause a fumble, but the official was right there on top of the play and did not rule it dead, and Burns makes the big pickup. This young man had two interceptions last week versus Lamar. He's appearing to be Johnny on the spot for the Falcon defense.
Close call, but no hesitation by the referees, and Hudson on that play doesn't have a prayer. Good play that time by the front line, the entire front line of Hartsville.
Good job of pinching down that time on Orlando. Orlando's coming up from center. He's looking to make a quick throw. The Hartsville defensive secondary is doing a great job of chucking receivers and staying in close contact with them so that he can't find the receivers quick. And that's one of the things you got with Scott and Travis out there. If you can get to the ball of these guys quick, well, they can go.
Yep. Two receivers to the right side. Hudson wants to throw quick, but he's not going to do it. Back-to-back sacks for Hartsville, and I guess that fumble just got them angry.
Really upset number 63, Fred Turner. Fred's a 6'1", 190-pound junior. Not a lot of size up front for the Hartsville defensive front. You look at Tommy Carpenter, 158. This is a rebuilding year for these guys. Normally they've got some huge players up front.
Well, that's what I wanted to talk about. Terrell Cherry, the nose guard, number 28 for Hartsville. He's 5'4", 148 pounds, and he's playing nose guard. We've got a new quarterback in the ball game now for Darlington, Jimmy Smith, and Smith's going to try his hand, and Smith is complete. His first pass comes into the ball game, and he completes the pass to Ernest Ratliff. Actually, no, that's
Patrick Barber, the tight end. They took DeBose and Hudson out, put in Barber.
Patrick Barber right down the middle. What a target he is.
And that spot's been open all night. Hudson hit the long pass, missed the long pass earlier. The middle of the field's open. When Hartsville's taking chances, blitzing those linebackers, those safeties and free safeties and strong safeties are more concerned about the outside coverage on Smith and Travis.
Well, we talked about the seams. This time, Jimmy Smith fumbles the handoff out of center, and it happens again. Big play by Darlington, fouled up by a mistake. Hartsville has it. I believe it was recovered there by Fred Turner.
Yeah, Fred
number
Turner.
63.
Between Fred Turner and Jimmy Smith, Fred Turner's going to win that wrestling match. The Hartsville offense turns it over, and the defense comes up with a big play, but not necessarily the Hartsville defense. Darlington just offensively has really had limited success tonight.
Well, Coach Harrison apparently just wanting a spark here. Takes Hudson out of the ballgame and inserts Jimmy Smith. I don't think Orlando Hudson got hurt. He just took him out of the ballgame. And this time Coe has nowhere to go. So defense now getting involved here. Defensive struggle all of a sudden here in the second quarter. Not much running room for either team.
Nice
Coe
play that
just
time.
Hammered.
Number 58, Corey King, shed off the block of the tight end. Came down and shut that play down that time for the Purple Falcons.
Called Corey's number a couple times tonight. King doing a great job from that outside end position, getting it done. Second and 10 now for Hartsville. Once again, they stay in that I formation. Coe checking off the line of scrimmage. He wants to throw. He's got a man, throws it high. Ball was intended for number 20, Marcus Scott. But Marcus, not a very tall target. He's only 5'11". That one sailed over his head by a good foot and a half.
He came down to wide to the bottom of the screen and lined up in single coverage against Audrey McKay. And Travis saw that, checked off the line of scrimmage, and tried to hit him on a quick slant.
So that'll bring up third and 10. Might be a good time here, Lane, for some kind of draw or
they're going with
some kind of misdirection.
They're going with a double tight end set, eye backs. Got a little motion here.
Yeah, they're just going to go with that simple pitch. The pitch to the other Coe, Tim.
Oh, my gosh.
And what an effort. Tim Coe hits the pitch from Travis, and what a tremendous individual effort. Check this out.
All the motion did for number 21, which was Lawrence Wiles, came back in, made a nice crackback block, and Big TC goes over the top to pick up the first down and move the chains.
That's what you call a nose for that first down. A nose for the marker. He saw it, dove for it, got it. That was a big, big play. Keeps the drive alive for Hartsville.
Twin sets down at the bottom of the screen up for Hartsville. Casey Hawkins in 83, Charlie Bradshaw.
And the handoff goes right up the middle to Jordan, the fullback. Look at Coe. Travis Coe getting a lick in there.
He didn't get to play defense, so he has to get one in every once in a while.
Now, that's something we really haven't talked about. Not too many players on both of these teams play both ways.
I think the only exception to that rule may be Clint Jacobs, who starts at tight end for the Foxes. But you're going to see, like I said, Charlie Bradshaw is going to put a lot of time at the end position.
And Jimmy Bell for Darlington, who just had a little meeting there with Coe.
Tete-a-tete.
Yes. Mono on mono there, second and nine. Coe dropping back, straight drop. Little screen out to the right side, but it's played there nicely. Throws it to Tim Coe, his brother, and a nice tackle Darlington. It was picked up beautifully by number 22, Larry Page, the middle linebacker for the Falcons.
Good job for your middle linebacker, inside linebacker, to come out and make a play that time out on the screen pass. Tim's going to go back in the huddle and say, hey, bro, don't hang it up that much. Get the ball quick so I can make a move. Don't hang me out to dry there. Of course, you know, you never can tell what happened during the week. He might have done something to upset his older brother and said, I'll get you back in the game. I'll hang a screen pass on you. They'll take you out.
Hang you out to dry. It looked like that play had potential when it first started, but it just collapsed quickly. Minute 34 and counting before halftime. Hartsville trying to get another score before the break, and Coe has got a man. Beautiful catch that time. Jordan, the fullback, out of the backfield, just runs a flare out, makes the catch. But a gain of only about 4 yards, gets it across the 45 to the 46-yard line. Here's Coe.
Beautiful play fake that time. Held the outside linebacker, number 22, that's the inside linebacker, Larry Page, and allowed the fullback to get in behind him and made the play. But unfortunately, the ball was thrown so that the fullback could not continue. Corey Jordan could not continue upfield to pick up the first down yardage. Good tackle that time, and good finish by the Darlington defense.
Well, all Hartsville wants to do now is punt this ball away, pin Darlington deep in its own territory, and go into the locker room with a 2-touchdown advantage. Talk about this Hartsville team, Lane. State champs in 81, 87, 88, 7 lower state championships.
And their record of past players, you know, reads kind of like a who's who just from the last couple years. 2 years ago, Jody Caldwell was one of the best linemen in the state. He's a number two backup defensive end. You'll get a chance to see him tomorrow in Columbia,
probably putting some time in.
Dontez Williams is a prop 48. He'll play at South Carolina State next year. Haywood Jackson's at Chauhan Junior College up in North Carolina. Lawrence Mack's playing in the MEAC for Elizabeth City State. So they've had a lot of players going on to the next level from this program.
And what an atmosphere up here. I tell you, they love their football up here in Hartsville, and treated very nicely from the people here, and we're glad that everyone could be a part of this game of the week. Our fourth game of the season with many more to come. The only place to see live high school football right here on WMB, and there's a punt for you. That's going to pin him way back, but it is caught there by Rashawn Travis. Travis getting to the outside, and Rashawn has a seam taken down there. There's a flag on the play. He takes it down to about the 25-yard line. Let's check out this flag. I think it's probably a clip.
Definitely going to be a clip here. Travis does a great job. He set up three of his blockers perfectly. The last guy couldn't hold up. Had to make the push and push down a Hartsville defender in his back.
It's so tempting when you're back there and a guy, you want to take him out of the play. He turns his back at the last second, and you still got to make contact, and you end up
Travis had the play set up. He was screening it out and running it out towards the sidelines. If he could have just held off making the contact, if you're in that position, you're following the guy you want to block. The runner's right to your left. If you wait just a second, if Travis cuts back, you're in perfect position to make the play and make the big block. But if you make the block early trying to initiate it, you're going to get in trouble and get caught every time.
Clock winding down here in the second quarter, and Darlington is content just to run out the clock. 45 seconds and counting.
I think what we've seen, Terry, in this first half, though, is Darlington's failure to produce a running game has allowed Hartsville's defensive backs and the defensive front to really tee off on Orlando Hudson and make life miserable for him in the first half. We'll have to see what type of adjustments Harrison's able to make in the second half to try to establish that running game and give Hudson more time.
Keep in mind the lack of the ground attack from Darlington may be a big case of Travis Burns not being there, the junior, number 12, the tailback, carrying much of the load, slated to carry much of the load this year, and did so in the opener against Lamar, not in uniform, twisted ankle. He is sorely missed, and that is certainly evident here tonight.
They thought he was going to play tonight, but he just was unable to recover from the injury last week versus Lamar.
Well, we are at halftime in Hartsville. The home team on top of the Darlington Falcons, 14-0. Travis Coe, the engineer thus far, and the Red Foxes on top of the Falcons. We will be back live in Hartsville with halftime festivities right after this.
Good credit, bad credit, we can help at Rent-A-Center, the largest rent-to-own center in the world, where you can rent name-brand appliances, name-brand furniture, big-screen TVs, VCRs, and more, all at low weekly or monthly rates with no down payment. We'll even deliver it to you for free. Rent real diamond and gold bridal jewelry with no credit check and no deposit. We're also the only company in town that rents pagers. If you need it, come to Rent-A-Center for no hassles and great service. Located in the Hallmark Shopping Center on South Irby Street in Florence.
She don't know who she messing with.
Here's your chance to see the show that everyone's been talking about. Gullah Productions presents A Joyful Sound, backed by overwhelming demand for two big shows, September 2nd and 3rd, Saturday at 7 p.m. and Sunday at 6 p.m. at the Myrtle Beach High School Auditorium. It's the show the Sun News calls a welcome addition to the Myrtle Beach area. Get your tickets now at these locations or charge by phone at 448-4566. A Joyful Sound. If you've seen it once, you've got to see it again.
Gus Lloyd created the killer video game with cool-looking villains like this. But something went terribly wrong because the characters he created came alive.
You, my friend, have created life.
Meet the Jackal, Gus's worst nightmare.
I couldn't have put it better myself.
He's sadistic, futuristic, and he and his henchmen are out to destroy the world. Christopher Lloyd stars in Deadly Games.
Deadly Games, 8 p.m. Tuesdays on TV 21.
Welcome back to Kellytown Stadium for our WWMB Game of the Week. You know, Hartsville is not just known for football. They've got a pretty good band tradition as well. The Red Regine, long tradition of excellence. This band has finished among the top 10 4A marching bands for the past 6 years. And the band program as a whole has won South Carolina's highest band award, the Outstanding Performance Award, 18 times. The Red Regime's 1990 show is entitled For Those Who Served and Gave. It is a tribute to America's Armed Forces veterans, and tonight the band will perform their opening number from the show, a medley of the service songs of the Army, Navy, Air Force, and Marines. The band is under the direction of Rick Knight and Penny Rogers, with assistance from Ray Saul and Betty Joe Nichols. The drum majors, Roderick Thomas and Matthew Whitehead. Band captain is Reggie Andrews. Percussion captains are Sharice McPhail and Marcus Evans. And the guard captains are Nikki Williams, Janine Smith, and Brenda King. And we'd like to wish a 30th birthday to the director of this band, Mr. Rick Knight. So let's take a look and listen at the Red Regime Marching Band of Hartsville. Let's check out some halftime statistics. We could tell you that Hartsville just really controlled the clock, 15 minutes in time for possession. But the telling stat here, you look at rushing yards. The Red Foxes just grinding it out, 92 yards, and the Darlington running attack is just simply non-existent, minus 3 yards on the night. Passing yards just about even, and the turnovers, two of them for Darlington, have both come back to haunt them. No penalties for Hartsville thus far. So we're just about ready to hear the Hartsville band play the Red Regime. Very nice. The Hartsville High School Marching Band, the Red Regime, and once again, happy birthday to Rick Knight, the band director. Now let's take a look at the Scholastic highlight from Darlington High School.
Hello, I'm Dr. Kay McElveen, principal of Hartsville High School. Welcome to Hartsville High School, home of champions in academics, in arts, in applied technology, and in athletics. We are an interesting and diverse group of approximately 1,500 students and 140 faculty and staff. All Red Foxes bonded by a long-standing tradition of pride and a quest for excellence. From the outside, we look like many other schools, a 40-acre campus and a variety of classroom buildings. But it's not the buildings that make Hartsville High the home of champions. It's the attitude of students and teachers. That attitude is best captured by the goals of our school, in which we dedicate ourselves, students, faculty, and staff, to creating an environment of academic growth for excellence. Day after day, Hartsville High School is in the business of preparing students to be productive citizens. Hartsville High School, home of champions in the classroom and on the playing field. Our commitment to excellence continues into the 21st century.
G
Join WMB TV 21 and Mix 97.7 every Saturday afternoon at Wild Water and Wheels in Myrtle Beach for the Tato Wild Dance Party. It's going to be a slip, slide summer of fun at Wild Water and Wheels every Saturday afternoon from noon until 2 for the Tato Wild Dance Party. Come dance the afternoon away at Wild Water and Wheels, the Tato Wild Dance Party on WMB TV 21.
High above Melrose.
I suspect we have a lot in common.
Light years beyond Beverly Hills.
I was just,
playing doctor.
Lies the hottest place in the universe.
Am I really ready to have a child?
And a new season of drama and discovery.
You think it's a sexual attraction?
In space, the nightlife never stops. Star Trek Voyager, Year 2.
8 p.m. Mondays on TV 21.
It's the most awesome video game ever. And you don't even have to buy it to try it. All you gotta do is watch UPN. We're talking mega cool. And there's only one rule. No rules. Get ready to play Deadly Games.
8 p.m. Tuesdays on TV 21.
Picture the people in your life, your close friends, the perfect wife. Now, picture a man who has the power to take it all away.
Kill him!
Thomas Vail's camera has uncovered a global conspiracy, a hidden agenda, and the dark forces behind it are out to erase every trace of his existence. Terror like this has never been seen on network television. We're talking Nowhere Man.
9 p.m. Mondays on TV 21.
Welcome back to a packed house here at Kellytown Stadium. Terry Gern along with Lane Harris. Halftime continuing here. And Lane, the second half, we'll see if Hartsfield's going to go to the air. They probably shouldn't have to because of what they did in the first half running the ball. But when they did throw the ball, they had some success, their second touchdown.
Yeah, that's what the strong running game can do for you. It really sets up the pass. And that's what Darlington wants to do, but they haven't been able to do it. Hartsfield has. And that allowed Cody to just fake a little sweet play there, and he runs his tight end across against the grain, and that's going to free Clint Jacobs up for a 35-yard touchdown to put Hartsfield up 14-0.
Clint Jacobs dropped the ball in the first quarter. He probably could have caught and ran in for a touchdown. He made amends on that one, bobbled it, but hauled it in, and he's in there for six. Well, we saw the Hartsfield Scholastic highlight. Now let's take a look at the Darlington Scholastic highlight.
Welcome to Darlington High School, home of the Falcons. My name is Otto Winger, Jr. I'm principal of this new school. I would like to introduce you to Cherie Mack, a member of the Student Council Organization, who will give you some information about the school.
Hello. We are proud of our new school and looking forward to an exciting year. Darlington High serves students in grades 9 through 12. We have the opportunity to take advanced placement courses in English, math, and U.S. history, as well as honors and academic courses. The Applied Technology Center provides training in marketing, trade and industry, home economics, health occupations, graphics, and horticulture. Junior ROTC provides students with an introduction to military and leadership skills. Faculty, students, and parents make Darlington High a special place. We are all working together to make this an excellent school.
The Darlington High School Falcons for source of success in athletics, academics, and attitude. Thank you for visiting our school.
Looking to start your own business, but you don't have tens of thousands of dollars, yet you want to get involved with something that's proven profitable and secure? Well, consider the recent developments in telecommunications. It could be exactly what you've been looking for. Call STI and discover how you can become an authorized licensee of the major long-distance services. Imagine if you could provide long-distance services at up to a 40% savings. It's something that everyone in your area would want. This is a business that you can build to give yourself a residual monthly income, whether you continue to work or not. Telecommunications is a multi-billion-dollar industry, and for less than $8,000, You can be in the business for yourself, but you won't be all by yourself. Call STI for the guidance on how to become an authorized licensee of the major long-distance phone companies. Call today.
You can take the shortest way home, or you can go like this and do a few hundred things on the way. No wonder you're thirsty.
I'm just a guy.
Yeah.
Think that would work?
Sure, and you're cute.
You show up to the club and you've got bugs in your hair.
Check mark.
It is what you see.
Check mark.
Show us the
mark. He's what talk is all about.
Mark Wahlberg, 12 noon weekdays on TV 21.
Chill. Check mark.
Well, I tell you what, they really know how to entertain us at halftime. This is Raymond. It's a Hartsville tradition.
Excellent.
Raymond goes on out there at halftime, tees it on up, left-footed, mind you, and barefooted.
Actually, Raymond's a Darlington tradition that moved to Hartsville, and now he entertains the Red Fox faithful. And he's getting them up, always the showman. Raymond choked on his first one. Let's see how he does on this one.
It's up. It's on its way. It is short. Raymond just misses it, but I don't really understand his thinking here because, well, the first one he kicked already, and he missed it from 25. So he backs it up for a 35-yarder.
He was just getting warmed up. And he saw him after he kicked it, he stuck his fingers about 6 inches apart and said, I missed it by that much. And, Raymond, I'm sorry to tell you, bud, it was a little bit further than that.
Well, it's his first time on live TV. He's a little bit nervous. And he'll get him next time.
Just as the Darlington team was.
Well, entertaining first half so far from Hartsville, especially from Travis Coe, engineering a very meticulous offense and a very fundamentally sound offense. Lane doing it with the option, and really that option success is bringing a lot of other success, hence the passing plays and the misdirection.
And that just goes back to the game plan of the Hartsville Red Fox coaching staff. They've got a senior leader at quarterback, very quick, very explosive on the option play, presents a lot of threats for a defensive team. A young defensive team is really going to be at a disadvantage, and that's exactly what Darlington's got. They're starting three sophomores on the defensive side of the field, three junior defensive linemen, and a senior like Coe is really going to make, who makes the right reads, makes the right decisions, and with experienced coaching staff like Lineberg and his folks making the right calls, you're going to see Hartsville up, and that's what they're doing right now. They're really doing a good job of controlling the line of scrimmage. The Hartsville senior defensive line is controlling things. There's a good look at Terry McPhail, who scored on a 4-yard run in the first quarter. Right now, Hartsville's having their way, but Darlington, again, the same thing as last week in the Marion Mullins game. Only down two touchdowns, they've generated nothing offensively, so they got to be able to come out with something positive at halftime. Let's see what type of adjustments is made on the Darlington side of the ball to get back in this ball game.
Keep in mind that Darlington won the toss in the first half. They received but fumbled that kickoff. Hartsville recovered, went right in on the touchdown in five plays, so Hartsville will be getting the ball back here in the second half. So the Falcons, Lane, could really use a three and out here. Three real solid defensive plays, turn it on over, and it'll be interesting to see who comes out at quarterback for them when they do have the ball, whether it's going to be Orlando Houston or Jimmy Smith, who finished up the second half in place of Hudson.
There's a good look at Chucky Wilson, the 5'11", 212-pound senior linebacker. He's a leader on the defense this year for the Red Foxes.
Hartsville, 20 running plays in the first half for 92 yards. Man, you run 20 running plays for 95 yards, 92 yards in the first half. That is a coach's dream.
Well, you're cutting up 4.5, 5 yards a play, and that's what you're going to get to move the sticks. And you're controlling the ball game, and you're lulling that Darlington Falcon defense to sleep. And that's why they've had the success. Let's look and see if Darlington can establish some momentum defensively against the Red Foxes. Darlington's defense has shown signs of being effective. They've bottled Coe up a couple of times in the option. McPhail's been stopped on some critical plays. But there's a good look at Coach Gerald Harrison trying to establish this program as the linebacker has established the Hartsville program on the other side of the field. A brand new kids are all playing together for the first time. A lot of inconsistency I think they're going to find in their first year here. But he's got a lot of good athletes on his side of the ball.
Yeah.
The ball. If you had a lot of rookies, a lot of sophomores and juniors playing, you'd be concerned. But he's got some quality athletes over there in Hudson. His wide receiver, Rashawn Travis, and Brian Scott. As we said, Rashawn Travis, in Coach Harrison's words, a definite Division I college prospect with the world-class speed.
Yeah, it's interesting when you hear people talk about Darlington. They usually follow it up with, wait in a couple years, this team's going to be something else. McPhail takes the ball at the 40-yard line. Here comes Terry McPhail up the middle. He's got a seam, and he takes it out across the 35-yard line. Beautiful return that time by number 31.
Have to really credit the Hartsville special teams. They've been doing it on their punt receiving team in the first half, and their kickoff receiving team has really got them in good position, good execution, fundamentals. Linebacker's known for that.
Yeah, you see the Darlington defense kind of just walked onto the field here. They didn't have much of a hop in their step, just kind of moseyed on out here. So
if they don't get some enthusiasm over there, they'll be down three TDs before you know it.
Once again, that I formation, first and 10. Coe working down the line, the give to the fullback, Corey Jordan, and the defense was up for that one. It just kind of moved right on down the line with the play, and that's a good way to play that option. Just shut down the holes and make sure you cover the cutbacks.
Darlington's back in the 5-3 defense. Corey King on the defensive end. They seem to do a lot of running at Corey King. What Corey's going to try to do is just spread that option out and give his inside linebackers and outside linebackers a chance to come up and make the play. There's a good look at the middle. Page, Jelani Sly, and Antonio Mills for the Falcons.
Are you in favor of that, switching up the defense a lot when you go up against an option team?
If you got to, you've got to give that quarterback a different look. If you go with a different defensive front, every time he comes down the line of scrimmage, there may be a man there may not be a man there. It makes his reads a little more difficult, and he's got to change his mind every time he comes down the line. If you line up in a 5-3, every time he knows he's going to see a defensive end, and he knows he's got to read the end and pitch. If sometimes he comes up and an outside linebacker's got pitch support, he's got to worry about, if I turn the corner, is somebody going to be there in pursuit? So you just got to make Coe think, make him make a lot of decisions on the offensive side of the ball, and by mixing up the defenses, you can accomplish that type of look.
Nice run that time by Terry McPhail on second down. That'll bring up a 3rd and 3
from
the Hartsville 41-yard line. Big defensive play here for the Falcons. Coe taking his time. The counter play goes to McPhail. He's got the first down and more. Stays on his feet across the 45, taken down at the 48, but he gets the first down. Nice looking play right from the start for Hartsville. They did the old cross butt.
Chucky Moore makes the block on Draper Samuel. That was the block that keyed the play. Draper Samuel made some great penetration. Samuel, 6'2", 250-pound senior, was in the backfield, had his sights set on McPhail. Chucky Moore gets just enough of him to make the play go.
Nice run support by number 11, Brantley Jett, number 11. He's there, but he doesn't wrap him up. He may have been able to stop him short of the first down, but missed the tackle. Terry McPhail so far, 12 carries for 45 yards.
Marshall Stoker, number 6, he's in the defensive line position now for Darlington.
Two receivers to the right side as Coe works his way down the line, but just meets a big old wall in the form of Corey King. Number 58 is everywhere.
They ran that option, that play that time, right at the new guy that came on the field. Stoker came in. They ran the fullback right into him. Stoker was there to make the play. And unfortunately for Darlington, Corey King, there's a good look at Corey right there. 6'2", 225, got good size, plays a defensive end position well. He's going to be at the wide side of the field, so he's going to be facing that option a lot.
Darlington seems to do a good job on first downs. It's second and third that is really starting to hurt them. And there's Terry McPhail on second down. McPhail has got a lot of room to the left side. And Terry McPhail is finally driven out of bounds at the 16-yard line. But a big gain on the play. Terry McPhail just bursts it right up the middle. We talked about it. They hold him on first down, but then they come right back on second down and let him rip off a big 30-yard gain.
Just power football right there. That time McPhail just ducked in behind his fullback, Corey Jordan, off the left tackle, running behind Jacoby Arnold and Bernard Dixon, the two seniors with good size on the left-hand side, picked up good yardage.
poor tackle that time by Jelani Sly. Instead of taking him down, he just rode him out of bounds, and McPhail picked up another 10 yards after the contact.
McPhail approaching the century mark, 75 yards rushing now on the night with 8:44 remaining in the third quarter. Hartsville knocking on the door once again. Second and we'll call it about seven from just inside the 15-yard line. Darlington desperately in need, Lane, of some kind of turnover or something that's going to help propel them here. They get down by three touchdowns, they're going to be in a big old hole to dig out of.
Bradshaw and Hawkins in at the wideouts for the Red Foxes.
Go play action, got some room to the left side, puts his head down. This kid is not running.
He's so quick, Jerry. when he puts the ball down to run, I mean, it looks like his feet are working in fast motion. Everybody else is in running in clay. Travis Coe, watch him. He just goes back to pass, and look at this. I'm going to scamper outside, and you better catch up with me, because if you don't break down, I'm going to run past you. Nice aggressive tackle that time by the Darlington defense. Maybe sending a message to Mr. Coe.
DeMarco Walker attempting to take Coe's head off with that tackle. Third and four now. This is a big play here. Let's see if Darlington can keep him out of that first down territory. The hand goes to McPhail, and Terry just lowers his head, and it looks like forward progress will be enough for the first down. It's going to be close.
It just dropped in that time behind 225-pound Chucky Moore and Leon Brown, the 250-pound senior on the right-hand side of the line. So Lewis Limeburger's got a lot of weapons he can call on. He's got some good size in the offensive line, and when he needs 3 yards, he knows where to go get it.
Give credit. That Hartsville line, they have certainly done the job here tonight. They're moving people around. The holes are there, and Terry McPhail, Travis Coe, the recipients, some big-time yardage. 7 minutes remaining, third quarter. The hand goes to McPhail, breaks one tackle before being stacked up at the five-yard line. So that'll bring up second and goal from the five. 14-0 Hartsville threatening to go up by three touchdowns.
Gerald Harrison bringing in some beef now. Number 79, Derek DeBose, 6'2", 280 coming in to play a little defensive line now. Try to stuff things up on the offensive defensive front for Darlington. Need to get some beef up in there. Right now, Harlington's controlling the line of scrimmage. Also in there, number 90, Mally Williams, a 6'1", 205-pound defensive lineman.
Well, this is exactly, Lane, what Darlington did not want to get into opening up the second half. This would be the 11th play of this drive.
That's textbook Hartsville offense. I mean, you control the line of scrimmage, run your bread and butter plays. When you need 3 yards, run off tackle behind your horses.
A lot of room.
Pitch the ball to McPhail.
To the right side, Terry McPhail's in for his second touchdown of the night. But there is a flag on the play. Let's check this out. See McPhail scoot to the outside there, showing some real quickness. And I think that one's going to be taken back. I believe it is a clip.
I think what they're going to call is the crack black block that time by the wide receiver. I didn't pick up his number. Got a little bit on the behind side of the Darlington defender. So now it's going to put Darlington in a chance where they can win a battle here. They're taking back out the beef, putting back in some more linebackers and defensive backs to try to speed up their coverage in the secondary, thinking that Hartsville will throw.
Well, here's the break they needed, the break that we've been talking about. But here's where Coe is really at his most dangerous. Second and 15, second and goal from the 15, actually. Now let's see what Travis Coe can come up with here for Hartsville.
Double tight end set.
Play action pass, he completes it. Touchdown, number 82, Clint Jacobs. His second touchdown on the night. And there you have it, folks, Travis Coe. Comes up with another huge play. That's just a tremendous pass.
Beautiful little belly fake that time. And the tight end last time was going against the grain. That time he slipped out into a little seam, almost like a little flag route, and Coe delivers the ball, something Hudson has not been able to do.
You know, you could almost feel it that was going to happen, because every time that Hartsville has been pushed back or something has gone against them, Coe has been able to come back with usually a pass play down that seam. And there's a extra point by Chris Jones. He's a perfect 3-for-3. And it is 21-0. Hartsville putting on a clinic here. With with 6 minutes, 7 seconds remaining in the third. Back after this.
Products Company, founded in 1899 in Hartsville, South Carolina. A world leader in package manufacturing, a world leader in recycling, a world leader in industrial safety. 17,000 team members providing customer satisfaction through excellence for more than 250 locations in 24 countries. Sonoco Products Company, packaging around the corner, around the world. Proud to call South Carolina home.
She don't know who she messing with.
Here's your chance to see the show that everyone's been talking about. Gullah Productions presents A Joyful Sound, backed by overwhelming demand for two big shows, September 2nd and 3rd, Saturday at 7 p.m. and Sunday at 6 p.m. at the Myrtle Beach High School Auditorium. It's the show the Sun News calls a welcome addition to the Myrtle Beach area. Get your tickets now at these locations or charge by phone at 448-4566. A Joyful Sound. If you've seen it once, you've got to see it again.
You're watching WWMB TV 21, Florence, Myrtle Beach.
Welcome, everyone. We are back in Hartsville, and another fumbled kickoff that time by Darlington, and they're going to start on offense at the 20-yard line. And Lane Harris, if you wanted to draw up a scoring drive, you'd do it this way. 11 plays, 66 yards, 6 minutes. That was just a clinic.
Not just a scoring drive, a break your heart, break your back type of scoring drive.
Exactly.
Because linebacker has the Falcons on the ropes, and he knew if he can come out and control this first series,
he can
get up on this game. Beautiful play that time by number 33 for Hartsville. Bashari Murray, Limeburger starting to clear the bench and get a look at some of his younger defensive players. Watch a little air time here by Bashari from the defensive end position, getting up in Hudson's way.
Murray trying to say, hey, coach, put me in on that starting lineup. Orlando Hudson is back in the game at quarterback and trying to complete one there. Once again, another pass, the in look, and that ball is dropped by Rashawn Travis. So nothing going right here for Darlington. Good-looking pattern run by Rashawn Travis, but he just can't hang on. It's like a domino effect. We saw this when Mullins was taking on Marion.
Yeah, you need somebody to step up here. Hudson's starting to deliver the ball, and you got competent, able receivers out there, and now they're starting to let down. So the frustration that the defense is feeling is rolling over the offense. The offense has yet to really establish anything. No running game to speak of, so they know Hudson's going to go back in the pocket and throw.
Yep, third and 10. And there's another looking pass. Rashawn Travis was wide open. He had room. That would have been a first down, but the ball is just not even close. Another incomplete pass will bring up another punt for Darlington. You know, we've been talking about the Hartsville offense and how potent they have been behind Coe, but this defense has been doing the job. They shut out Hillcrest last week. They're pitching the shutout here. Two goose eggs after the first 2 weeks. You're doing it.
And I think that's probably got to be the best surprise for Coach Lineberger as he goes into this season. Only two defensive starters returned, so he thought that was a big question mark for his team. But right now the Red Foxes are on a roll on defense.
And there's the punt handled by Coe at the 45. Travis Coe does a little spin action, gets past midfield. Travis still on his feet. Oh, man, and lowers the boom. The little man putting a licking on Darlington. Man, what a run.
He's been watching some film. He sets up the punt return team by changing his field, and he's got blockers over there. And let's see who the culprit is for the Darlington. Can't really see.
Oh.
To his defense, the defender was off balance, and Cope simply just ducked his shoulder and ran over him. But, you know, he's 5'4", 148. What kind of crushing blow can this guy deliver? I don't know. You might better ask the guy from Darlington.
Yeah, he is put together, folks. Do not be deceived by his stature. 5'4", but 5'4 explosiveness, and there's a handoff to his brother Tim, and Tim Coe really showing something here tonight. Every time he's gotten his hands on the ball, he's come up with positive yardage, just about 8 yards on the gain there. Bring up second, and we'll call it a long two from just inside the Darlington 35-yard line. Coe so far in the game, 5 for 7 passing. two of those have gone for touchdowns. Talk about making the most of your opportunities. I formation behind Coe. He's going to go to the air once again. He's running around a la Fran Tarkington here. Still on his feet. And they finally corral him. That's just got to send fits on the defensive line all night when you're chasing a guy like that.
And he's right over there in front of the Darlington bench, and the coaches are going, hit him, tackle him, get him down, just do something. Don't let him throw the ball. Don't let him break free because he's really got your defense stretched out.
I almost wish he had a mic on him so he's going, na-na-na-na-na. Travis Coe putting on a show.
Very, very elusive back in the backfield. You saw him drop back in the pocket that time, and the first defender that came at him had no chance. He just spun right out of that move, and his quickness is just going to make him very, very, very elusive.
He can stop a dime, and he has got that pivot spin down pat. Third down, loss on the play, third and eight, but they've usually converted on these long third down plays. Not this time. Tim Coe makes the catch, but he is wrapped up in a hurry. And that's going to be another loss, a loss of three on the play. So Hartsville's going to have to punt.
Nice play that time by number 11, Brantley Jett, coming up from his outside linebacker position. And again, there must be something going on with those Cowboys. That's the second time Travis has hung Tim out to dry on the swing pass.
Yeah, they got another completion.
It's Jason Dawkins back to punt now for the Red Foxes.
7 for 9 is Travis Coe. Another bad snap. That's the second bad snap on the night here for Hartsville. High hanger. That's a nice punt. Fielded at the 5-yard line by Travis. Rashawn Travis has got some room on the left side. Travis is on his feet across midfield, knocked out right at about the 50-yard line. Beautiful return by Rashawn Travis, and 42 yards brings it to midfield, and now they really have to capitalize on this.
We talked about Travis Coe's speed because we see him handle the ball every play.
Yeah.
This is the first time we've really seen this young man in the open field, and it's 4-4 burners down the sideline. You see him leave that Hartsville defender in his wake. Nice pickup block at the time on McPhail. 20 for Hartsville, comes in from behind Marcus Scott to make the play.
Hudson still in the ball game, and yet another drop pass by Darlington. This is just unbelievable. Brian Scott this time couldn't find the handle. And that is just demoralizing when you're the quarterback. It's one thing when it's your fault when you throw it low or high, but that was right in the breadbasket.
It's completely inconsistent offense. When Hudson's able to deliver, the receivers aren't able to catch. When the receivers are
exactly
open, Hudson can't deliver.
They've got Mr. Murphy hanging over their heads. Can go wrong, will go wrong. Another three-step drop. Looking past. This time it's a complete. And this time Brian Scott hangs on, and he hangs on for the first down, but not after he takes a big-time hit. And Scott is hurt. Let's check this out.
That's Clint Jacobs coming up from the free safety position. Oh, looks like one of the linebackers. That's 61. That's Chucky Wilson coming over from the outside and putting the pads on him. But that's the kind of explosiveness that this offense can give you. If you try to single cover these guys and they hit a seam on that in pattern, you can say goodbye because they're gone.
Well, hey, the seams have been open all night long. It's just a matter of the not connecting here by receiver quarterback. And that one is high. Oh, he hung him off the drive big time. And what a punishing hit that time by Tim Coe. He just really put a curtain on Don DeBose, the tight end. And DeBose is still feeling it. Oh, you can feel that one in your living room. That's when you're just gasping for air. That's a definite wind jammer.
They did a good job of setting that play up. Aside from they've been running the slant pad on the wide receivers. They're trying to get the corner to bite on that slant play. They ran the slant again. Go ahead and run it, Jerry. And when they ran the slant that time, all they're doing is they're just tickling out the tight end. But Hudson hangs the ball up way too high. You got to deliver the ball quicker. Please deliver it quicker next time. Oh,
you know, I got to hand it to that young man, DeBose, stretching out like that. A lot of guys would have never done that because no doubt he was hearing footsteps that time. Tim Coe just lowered the boom.
To his defense, he was concentrating on the ball.
Yeah.
Most guys would look down and look for the defender. The defender was definitely there. Good to see Don DeBose, a 6'1", 220-pound junior tight end, get up and jog this one off. I don't think we've seen the last of that young man. And they've also got a competent backup for him. The young man that came in and replaced him in the second half came in and caught a big pass play over the middle, Patrick Barber. And it looks like Barber's in the game right now at tight end.
Well, it is 2nd and 10 at the Hartsville 40-yard line. Hudson this time with a 5-step drop. He's got time. Hudson going deep. He's got a man. There is. And the flag will come out. There is some bumping going on down there. Brian Scott claps his hands because it is pass interference on Hartsville, and the Falcons will take it any way they can get it at this point. That's a pretty good pass that time by Hudson. Didn't overthrow him. He had him.
Pretty long pass, too. He's still kind of overthrew him. I don't think if he had not gotten the contact, he'd be standing up. But that's something that Hudson's arm will give you. Most of the your high school defenders are not going to be able to hang with a receiver that long. And what we saw that time is Scott Speed got him downfield in his frame at 6'3", 185 pound against the 5'10". Brad Lawson allowed Scott to get open, and Lawson lost his footing and made the contact. Excuse me, it was Clint Jacobs coming over from his free safety position. Jacobs had an interception last week against the Hillcrest of Dalzell with a 21-yard return, but unable to come up big. Jacobs only 5'9", so he's given up a good 6 inches to Scott on the outside.
Automatic first down at the 22-yard line. Here's Hudson, looking pass. Oh, and another big hit.
Chucky Wilson.
Chucky ringing
the bell, Chuck.
Hey, but hand it to Brian Scott. He pops right back up. He's used to it at this point, I guess. He's been getting hammered on most of the night.
That's why a lot of receivers don't like to go over the middle. Don't send me over the middle, coach. It's hot in there. And Chucky Wilson's lining up and laying the leather to him.
These guys aren't afraid to go across the middle. Second and three. Hudson trying to air it out again. Look out. Oh, and a big-time loss that time. A huge defensive play by number 63 for Hartsville, Fred Turner. The junior, 6'1", 190 pounds, Lane. This is a huge defensive play.
Good job that time. He just came from the outside and took Mustafa Stanley, the fullback, out of the play, and Fred gets just enough jersey to take Orlando down. Darling has been doing a good job of using those post patterns, those quick post patterns, to try to pull those corners in. Let's look for maybe a little hitch and go to get around the outside and try to get deep.
Loss of seven on the play. Split receivers, third and 17.
It's coming back.
Hudson, pump fake. He's going deep once again. He has Scott out there. Incomplete.
Another
flag on the play.
Well, it's going to negate each other because it was a legal procedure penalty on Wilson at the line of scrimmage. A little go right before the snap. So these are going to offset. We're going to have another third and long.
We've got pass interference in the end zone, but another flag in the backfield. Orlando Hudson is not shy about airing it out.
But that's exactly what we saw that time, Terry. What he did is he faked the end route to the other receiver.
Exactly
on the other
side
of the field, the receiver ran an end pattern and then cut it out to the outside and found some opening on the outside corner over there.
Setting them up.
Kind of a post flag route.
Right. You keep going inside and you pop it to the outside. When they bite, you take off.
Exactly.
And that was working.
It worked that time. Unfortunately, just a slight stutter right before the ball was snapped by Scott kept them from being able to set up inside the 10-yard line.
Well, the Hartsville defenders have their ears pinned back, and they have most of the night, because Darlington is just not running the football. Orlando Hudson's arm must be hanging right now. He's throwing again, third and 17.
He's there.
A timing play. He's got Scott. Scott makes the catch down at the 1-yard line. What a beautiful pitch and catch that time. Hudson to Scott, but Scott is down. We'll have to check on this. Beautiful timing.
This time he caught the Foxes in a zone defense. And as soon as Scott came around the corner, there's not enough time for the number 20 for Hartsville to get over and make the Scott. Marcus Scott could not get over to Brian Scott and stop that play. Beautiful catch. As you said, a little pitch and go that time with Orlando and Brian.
Hand it to the Falcons. They are not giving up here. The clock is ticking down in the third quarter. 40 seconds. First and goal from the one. Hudson calls his own number. No signal yet. Another flag on the play. And if this is against Darlington, I am just not going to believe it. It is just amazing. Every single time they have a big play, they follow it up with a bad play, with a mental mistake.
That's just a legal procedure penalty, probably from an interior lineman or a wide receiver. What this is going to do, though, your lack of running game is really going to hurt you right here. When you get down in the red zone, this close to the end zone, you're going to have to be able to your offensive line is going to have to be able to open a hole for you. With no running game to speak of, Darlington's going to have to get real creative here.
Well, I have a feeling I know what the Falcons are going to be working on at practice this week.
Well, they worked on it all last week against Lamar. I mean, Coach Harrison said, you know, we ran the ball 42 times last week. We're not going to do that on a weekly basis. They tried to establish that attack against Lamar. And again, playing against Hartsville, you got to feel like if you can run against this kind of defense, you're going to be able to do well in the region. And I'll tell you what, the folks in Region 6, 3A, the Myrtle Beaches, the Shiraz, the Marions, the teams that they'll be playing against, they better keep a close eye on this team, because if they can't establish a running game, they'll be almost unstoppable, because Hudson and company can make it work.
Here's Hudson, that timing pass again. Scott is there. Touchdown, Darlington. The Falcons get on the scoreboard with 20 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Hudson to Scott.
You're going to see that play a lot. The 6'3 Scott is going to be matched up against small corners almost every night, on every Friday night. And this young man is going to put up some big numbers. He had 5 catches for 28 yards last week against Lamar, and he's putting up some pretty big numbers right now.
The old jump ball that time, and Brian Scott comes up with it. He's got to be the MVP so far for Darlington. He's getting it done defensively. Mr. King's doing a good job, too, for Darlington. Here's the point after, and it is up and good. So Darlington still has some fight left in them. It's 21-7 now with 20 seconds remaining in the third quarter. So Darlington gets the goose egg off the board lane, and they finally capitalize on a couple breaks and showing their resiliency.
Yeah, they got a good crowd that came over here with them tonight.
Yeah,
from
actually
Darlington.
They do. That's a good point, you know. And look at those stands over on the other side. They are filled right up.
And then right now they're huddling at midfield. The offense has accomplished something tonight. They've broken the goose egg. The defense is starting to show a little bit more consistency. Linebacker's philosophy is going to be this. Hey, guys, let's do exactly what we did the first time. Let's take the ball, control it, march down the field. Don't turn the ball over. We've only seen one Hartsville turnover tonight. It didn't hurt them, and that's been the staple of this Red Fox team, their ability to control the ball. On the other side of the field, turnovers and just inconsistency on offense for Gerald Harrison has been their downfall in this game.
Yeah, don't expect Hartsville to push the panic button. A senior-laden ball club, they are experienced. Let's check out that scoring drive now by the Falcons. And it was a good one, 7 plays. They travel 50 yards in just under 3 minutes, 2:40. The touchdown pass from Hudson to Smith, to Brian Scott, rather. And it's a 2-touchdown game once again. Terry McPhail bobbles the ball at the 11-yard line, picks it back up, and McPhail still on his feet. Out across the 30-yard line, finally stacked up at about the 32. So Hartsville will take over. Let's see what that Darlington defense can dish out here as the third quarter expires. Got a pretty good ball game now from Kellytown Stadium, 21-7. Hartsville on top of Darlington. You see the fours being raised in the air. We are heading to the fourth quarter. Let's see if Darlington's got anything left for the Red Foxes. We'll be back in Hartsville right after this.
Good credit, bad credit, we can help at Rent-A-Center, the largest rent-to-own center in the world, where you can rent name-brand appliances, name-brand furniture, big-screen TVs, VCRs, and more, all at low weekly or monthly rates with no down payment. We'll even deliver it to you for free. Rent real diamond and gold bridal jewelry with no credit check and no deposit. We're also the only company in town that rents pagers. If you need it, come to Rent-A-Center for no hassles and great service. Located in the Hallmark Shopping Center on South Irby Street in Florence.
Name is Kramer.
You're not normal.
What do you say about a guy like this, huh?
His buttocks are sublime.
Said I was a hipster doofus.
Can't you see I'm burned out?
My boys need a house.
Yo, yo, ma.
I'm Kramer.
5 times a week.
Oh, baby.
Coming this fall to TV 21.
Gus Lloyd created the killer video game with cool-looking villains like this. But something went terribly wrong because the characters he created came alive.
You, my friend, have created life.
Meet the Jackal, Gus's worst nightmare.
I couldn't have put it better myself.
He's sadistic, futuristic, and he and his henchmen are out to destroy the world. Christopher Lloyd stars in Deadly Games.
Deadly Games, 8 p.m. Tuesdays on TV 21. You are watching WWMB TV 21, Florence, Myrtle Beach.
And we are back. First play from scrimmage for Hartsville, no gain. And Lane, you really got to hand it to Darlington. despite the one-dimensional offense, they're still able to march down the field 50 yards and get it into the end zone down three touchdowns.
What they're doing is, they're, like you said, they're playing pitch and catch. Orlando is the best athlete on the team. He's got two competent receivers, and he's been able to get that. All that, again, was set up by the nice punt return by Rashawn Travis. So what you see there is you see the Darlington offensive weapons being highlighted.
Well, let's see what Travis Coe can come up with here for the Red Foxes. Little movement on the line there for Darlington. No flag. The pitch to McPhail. They had him in the backfield for a loss, but the very elusive Terry McPhail squeezes up there for a gain of 3 yards. That's making something out of nothing. Very good run by McPhail, because instead of third and nine, it's going to be third and about, well, we'll call it five.
McPhail's a tight package, too. 5'8", 168. He's a senior, too. He's given a lot of leadership. Senior-laden backfield, Coe, Jordan, and McPhail for Hartsville. They've been with this program. They've been through the weights for 3 years. They're real strong, and they know the offensive scheme for Leinberger.
I tell you, some of these Hartsville kids are out there working out or throwing the ball around before the game without their shirts on. These guys are cut. They are ready for football. And there's a pitch to McPhail. Terry McPhail is still on his feet near the 45. Let's see if they call him down. I'm not sure if his knee touched. That's going to be very close. I believe he got the first down, though. That's, yes, indeed.
Let me tell you something else, Terry. Where this conditioning comes in, you're seeing the Darlington players getting up off the ground real slow.
Yeah.
You see these Hartsville guys popping up, going back to the huddle. The conditioning is a huge factor in this program.
Well, you take a shot in the sidelines, too. Look at all the Darlington guys that are on the sidelines, on the far sidelines, on one knee. Helmets to their side, and they're just gasping for breath over there. Meanwhile, everyone else on Hartsville's side is standing up. That might have something to do with the lead, too, but... Regardless, it is 21-7, 10 minutes remaining in this ball game. Offsides. Coe, for the second time in the ball game, draws the defense off and gains a quick 5 yards.
He's got a little bit of a head bob in that cadence call, too. He's really doing a good job of heightening that signal call to bring the Darlington offsides. And there you see the Darlington offensive team over there. That's fullback Mustafa Stanley catching his breath. Because they got a lot of work to do tonight. If they get a chance to get the ball back, the passing attack of Darlington is not going to eat a lot of clock. On the other hand, Hartsville's main goal is to run the ball, run it successfully, and eat clock.
Well, hey, when you throw the ball every down, you're going to run out of steam after a while. McPhail, nice cutback. He gets the first down. He's across the 45, taken down at about the 41-yard line. Good run once again by Terry McPhail.
He's
a workhorse.
And he's really a great job. You saw him pop out from behind the block of number 60, 76, Jacoby Arnold. Jacoby is a big fella, 6'2", 298, senior. McPhail does a good job of hiding behind him. And, folks, what you're looking at right now, Darlington is not in a position to trade touchdowns with Hartsville. They've got to come up with a defensive stop. And the way Hartsville's offensive line is controlling the line of scrimmage right now, it's not going to happen.
They've got to come up with a defensive stop in a hurry. First and 10, 42-yard line. The delayed handoff goes to McPhail. Hit in the backfield, but once again, he finds a way to get loose. Jimmy Bell was there initially. Also, could have been a loss of 3 yards, but instead, once again, it's a gain of four.
There's number nine, Jimmy Bell, with his back to you. Larry Page also comes up. Jimmy just sheds off. Here comes 22 Page, overruns the play. McPhail cuts back and picks up positive yardage. On what could have been a 3-yard loss is now a 4-yard gain.
He was square to the ball, square to the runner. Looked like he had him, just didn't wrap him up.
Another gentleman we haven't called his number much tonight. It's the quarterback of that offensive line, number 51, Chet Hope, the 6-foot, 230-pound senior, starting for his second year for Coach Lewis Leinberger.
And that'll be a flag on Hartsville. Let's check out the third quarter statistics now to this point. Rushing yards is the story, minus 13. Darlington.
There's three or four quarterback sacks that have added to that total tonight. The two first downs.
Real turnovers in that.
First
now remember, these are just statistics from the third quarter. There. First downs in the game. The pitch to Tim Coe. Coe's got some room on the outside. He's taken down. And that's a gain of about four. That's going to bring up a second and 8.
Antonio Mills looked like he was in a good position to make that play. And again, another good block by 76, Chobia Arnold. Kept him away from Coe and allowed Coe to pick up some good yardage. Now third and long. Let's see if if Hartsville goes to the air. They bring in number 14, Robert McDaniel, who's a sophomore, 6 foot, 158-pound flanker. So we're seeing a lot of new receivers in now for Hartsville. Let's see what Coe does under center.
And he's got some room out there, split to the right side. Man alive, there's another mistake by Darlington. It's tough, though. Antonio Gardner, you're so hyped up about making a play, and you hear that stuttered cadence, you can't help. It's so enticing to jump across. Third time in this ball game, Coe's done it, but you're supposed to watch the ball,
Antonio,
right?
Antonio, you're right in front of the ball, bud. It's right there in front of you. You're almost sweating on top of it. Don't listen to Travis. Watch the ball.
That's what the coach is telling you.
What they teach you all summer long, getting ready for this kind of game. And now push from third and six to third and one. You get the ball to McPhail. Pick up the first down.
Third and one indeed from inside the 35-yard line. Coe under center. Long count, trying to draw him off again. The handoff right up the middle to the fullback, Corey Jordan. Haven't called his number all that much tonight, but Corey rumbles his way across the 30, down to about the 25-yard line. Gain of about five on the play. He gets the first down, and the tacticians are at it again. Another surgical-type drive put together by the Red Foxes as we take a look at Tim Coe, who's had himself a ball game here, Lane. That's a cramp for sure.
Looks like they're looking at that up that lower thigh right there, straightening the leg out. Doesn't seem to be any. I don't know. They look like they might be working a little bit more on the knee area for Tim. Hopefully he's going to be okay.
Big kid. Ball's on the ground. Travis Coe covers it up. I think that would be the first bad play of the game for Travis Coe. He is human, after all.
Haven't seen many of those. Maybe it was because he didn't have his brother in there to pitch to. He kind of lost his head there for a second.
Terry McPhail has gone over the century mark. 21 carries, 110 yards. I'm very impressed with this kid, Lane. He has just been a workhorse. I'm not sure if he sat out one offensive play. It seems like he's back there every time the ball is snapped, and he's really done the job. Second and 11 now for Hartsville.
They slide Jordan over from the fullback position to break up the eye a little bit.
And here's Coe to pass. They're setting up a screen, and he can't quite get it to McPhail. Incomplete. That'll bring up third and 11.
That's good. They got to call that a lateral ball.
Go through that behind him.
So that could have been a big play for Darlington. So
that's a good job by McPhail to get on that one. Cover it up, live football. Refs are talking it over. And that indeed is the call. So it is a loss of a good 5 yards on the play.
Let's take a look at that one, because Coe dropped back in the pocket. McPhail flared out, and Coe actually delivered this ball a little too early. If he sets up in the pocket, the Darlington rush comes more towards him, and McPhail's got a lot more room to believe. But that was a lateral, a backwards pass.
Well, we said it before, bad play from Hartsville usually followed up by a good play. It is third and 19 from the 35. Let's see what Travis Coe comes up with. He's got receivers split to both sides. Here's Coe. He's laying it on up there. He's got a man. Oh, and it is almost caught out of bounds, though. Good idea by Hartsville, but Marcus Scott can't come down with it.
We saw the Darlington defenders working on this play before the game. They were working on the fade route. The coaches were imploring the defenders, you know, use your shoulders. Keep your contact with your shoulders, not your hands. You don't want to draw the penalty there. But just as the ball was thrown, number 20, Tracy Burns makes the right play. The 5'10", 140-pound junior come up with a nice bat down and forced the receiver out of bounds.
Well, Darlington does the job. They get the ball turned over to them, but not quick enough. Time is just ticking away here in this fourth quarter. A rapidly moving fourth quarter. That ball punted out of bounds. They'll probably spot it at about the 22-yard line, 23-yard line. That's where Darlington will take over. And there's your man, Travis Coe, getting it done tonight. 5'4", 160-pound senior. He is the spark plug, and I think that is a perfect word for this guy. Sparks are what he creates when he touches the football.
Just another day at the office.
Yeah.
Option quarterback is really going to put a lot of pressure on defenses this year.
Here's Hudson airing it out. He's going real deep. Kid can sling the football, but overthrows the receiver once again. And you know what, Lane? Hartsville didn't score on that last drive, but it really doesn't matter because they just chewed up the clock.
They chewed up 5 minutes of clock on that drive, Terry. Moved the ball about 50 yards. No mistakes, no fumbles. Didn't put themselves in a bad position. Only during that last play at third and 18, they were able to cash in on the long play. But that's what you're going to find. This is a well-disciplined team. Very consistent team, and one that's going to really make a lot of noise this year.
The Falcons using the no-huddle offense with 4:25 to go in the ball game. Here comes the blitz from Hartsfield. It is picked up nicely by Darlington. The catch is made and out of bounds.
Not a very smart play.
Not
a very smart play that time by Scott. He just laid down on the playing field. He could have easily gotten out of bounds and stopped the clock.
Thought I saw a flag, but there is not. Pickup is made by Scott. He gets the first down. Ball is spotted at the 35, and Orlando Hudson just trying to hurry things up here. Hudson has Scott once again. Little pitch and catch, as we talked about. Nice job by Brian Scott to avoid the first tackler. He gets it out across to the Hartsfield 45-yard line.
What they're doing that time on the cornerback for Hartsfield, number 24, is Brad Lawson. Brad Lawson's playing way inside of Brian Scott, and they're almost challenging him to throw the long pass. The free safety's lying in the weeds over there, Clint Jacobs, to make the play on that. Now they're going to tighten up Lawson over on Scott and take that play away from him. Let's look and see if Orlando Hudson goes to Travis.
There's that timing play. Oh, what a catch by Scott. He hauls it in, and
he's out of bounds.
He's out of bounds at two. There is absolutely no quit in the purple and gray. They're trying to build some tradition with this high school.
They brought Lawson up to try to bump him, and he bumped him, but the free safety, Clint Jacobs, did not get over there to
wasn't
make
there
the play.
Help. Right.
There's no help there, so Jacobs has to make the tackle late. Nice little tightrope, barely steps out at the 1 yard line.
Little pirouette action by Brian Scott. He has just played a whale of a ball game here. And with 3:54 remaining in the game, we have a timeout on the field. We'll be back with the final 3:54 as Darlington is knocking on the door, 21-13.
Motown, the hit machine that produced the biggest stars, the best songs, and that unstoppable beat. Now, for the first time in years, 40 of Motown's greatest songs are available on Motown Love, featuring The Temptations, The Jackson 5, Diana Ross and the Supremes, Motown Love features over 2 hours of digitally remastered Motown classics. Motown never sounded better. And as a bonus, you'll get Motown's newest stars, Boys to Men. To save COD charges, use your credit card or send check or money order. Two CDs, $26.99. Two long play cassettes, $21.99. Rush delivery available.
This is WWMB TV 21, Florence, Myrtle Beach.
And goal for the Falcons. 3:54 remaining in this ball game. It is 21-7. Hartsfield on top. Flag on the play before that ball is even snapped. So we're going to check this out, see who it's against. We've had a lot of dirty laundry on the field here tonight.
If this is against Darlington, I mean, they got to have something going on that left-hand side of the ball, because they've not been either not getting set. They're going to call the Hartsfield defense offside. They were really fired up on that play. They had 9 men on the line of scrimmage. They're trying to chuck Scott at the line of scrimmage to take him out of the play. You got to be able to have a fullback that can get up in the line of scrimmage right now. 44, Mustafa Stanley. We've seen he hasn't carried the ball all night. 33, Stanley. 44 is Casey Samuels, hasn't touched the ball either. Orlando's going to keep it himself, and he's in there.
Hudson is in for the touchdown, and that'll make it 21-13 with 3:45 remaining. Boy, they got downfield in a hurry, Lane. That hurry-up offense getting it done.
Those three pass plays from Hudson to Scott covered about 76 of those 77 yards. Hudson takes the last yard himself, but that's what the big play offense can do for you. That's what this wide-open attack can do for you. It's not going to cut a lot of clock, but if you're not thinking, if you're not making the right decisions on defense, which Hartsfield didn't do in that series, it can hurt you.
Hudson has thrown the ball 20 times tonight. Here's the point after attempt from Jeremy Strickland, the senior.
Blocked.
Oh, and he misses it. It's blocked. And that is a big, big play.
Let's see if we can see who got it. Got through there. A lot of penetration that time by Hartsfield. Tim Coe was in there. 67. Chucky Moore was in there. Also, Chucky Wilson, number 61. Let's see if we can see who gets the hand on. 63, right in the middle of the line is Fred Turner. Came through with a tackle. It was a very low kick.
Yeah, the snap was there, the hold was there, and Strickland just hit the ball a little high. Very low kick, and it was blocked. So it is 21-13 here in the fourth quarter. Hartsville on top of Darlington. Darlington showing its resiliency with a couple of scores here late in the game. 3:45 remaining. Hartsville will return. Lane, what do you do here? Do you kick it deep or do you try to get a squibber and try to bounce it off someone and recover the football?
Well, if you try to go for the squibber and Hartsville gets it, they don't have very far to go, and they've shown a propensity to really eat clock. I think Darlington's got a good enough kicking game. The kicker is Brian Scott's the kicker, and he's been able to get the ball inside the 10-yard line consistently. I think you got to kick it deep and try to get your coverage guys down there. Hartsville, I've really been impressed with their kickoff and punt return teams. They do a great job of getting good field position for this offense. And if they continue to do that, this will be a very short night. Linebackers, what he's doing is moving his players up. He's going to move his two up backs up to try to make sure they get some hands up there. And it looks like they got the good hands team. They got some wide receivers and some running backs and defensive backs up there on that front line to try to pick this up in case it is an onside kick. But I anticipate Scott going deep with it and Trim trying to make a defensive stop and get the ball back as soon as possible.
Brian Scott has been the hero so far for Darlington. Good look at him there. The Brothers Coe back to receive this one. See if they go with the squibber.
They're moving some people around. Looks like they're going to set up for the offside. Linebacker's imploring his players to move up, and now they're starting to do that.
And there's the onsider. Recovered nicely by Hartsville. They just didn't get that big old hop that you try to get. You try to get the two bounces and that third hop to really get up in the air. It just never happened.
It was a very sure hop, and number 88, Quincy Kosum, starting tight end, was Johnny on the spot. He gets one good hop. Right there's the kind of hop you want, but you want that hop to take place right before it lands into the hands of the Hartsville Red Fox. Fielded cleanly by Kosum. Hartsville setting up shop on the 49-yard line. Still plenty of time left. The defense has to come up big now for Darlington.
That was the old Sunday hop there for Hartsville. So let's see if they can chew up the clock as they've been able to do so far in the ball game. Darlington now bearing down on defense. First and 10. At Hartsville's own 49-yard line. Coe under center, the handoff to the big fullback, Corey Jordan.
Coe kept it off the tackle that time, Terry.
Faked me out. Coe kept it himself. It looked like he had the ball in there to Jordan. Take a look at that scoring drive. Sixth place, 77 yards in 1 minute.
A quickie. If you want a quickie, there's a quickie. Let me show you something that's happened now on the Hartsville sidelines. At midfield, there's an offensive coordinator for Darlington. He's holding up his hand. He's signaling Travis Coe when to call the play. They're going to eat up as much of that 25-second clock as possible to chew clock and put Darlington in a very deep situation if they do get the ball back. It looks like there's been a timeout on the field by Darlington.
This Hartsville coaching staff is one of the best school coaching staffs around. They really know how to work the clock and utilize timeouts and all the intricacies of coaching. Darlington really needs to come up with a huge play defensively here. They've had a couple tonight. They need one now. Got to hand it to this ball club. Win, lose, or draw.
They made a good showing. And this is the kind of team you could be ahead by three touchdowns, and if you don't keep playing, they can come out after you. Let's talk about those assistants. Charlie Burry, Alex Dabney, Terry McGarity, Bob Hayes, Marco Thompson, the assistant coaches for Lewis Lineberger. These guys do it all. And last year when Lewis Lineberger and their team went down in a very scary bus wreck on the way to a football game, these assistants stepped up and really pulled the load for Lineberger.
Second and four. Right up the middle. And there's your fullback, Corey Jordan. Doing the job. That's what he's in there for, getting those short yardage first downs. And that's a killer. They go across the 35-yard line. Ball is going to be spotted. Now we'll call it about the 33.
Good hard running there by Jordan. The Darlington tacklers are just not stepping up and making the hit and making the first hit and tackle. Number 9, Jimmy Bell, the sophomore outside linebacker, hobbled off the field for the second time tonight.
Darlington coaching staff, too, a whale of a job, though, too, when you think about it, Lane, having to come together and keep these kids united. I mean, think about it. These used to be kids that played against each
That's
other.
Right.
Now
That's
they're
right.
teammates. That's a battle in itself. Well, it's first and 10 now, and look at Coe just taking his time. There's the veteran. He gets the signal from the coach. The pitch to McPhail. He's got some room. Cut back. Oh, he's a slasher. Terry McPhail's got another first down, and that is a killer for Darlington.
Jacobia Arnold, Chucky Moore, Nard Dixon, Chat Hope, Leon Brown, the offensive line are just going to stretch this play out. And what happens is a Darlington lineman, defensive lineman, linebackers lose sight of McPhail behind that line. And all of a sudden he cuts back and you're moving out, thinking he's going outside. And that's why he's had a lot of success cutting back against the grain on this over-pursuing defense for Darlington.
122 yards now on the night for number 31, Terry McPhail. Cole, once again, chewing up the clock.
He's looking
210.
Looking over at his offensive coordinator, waiting for the sign.
Hand off to McPhail, trying to pad the stats, gets a couple there. 2 minutes remain in this ball game, and the clock continues to tick.
I don't know how many timeouts Darlington has left, if any, because they burned a couple early in this second half. So they may be out of timeouts. And what Coe's going to do is he's going to take his time, call his play in the huddle, and say, hey, listen, horses, just open me a hole. Let me get 3 to 4 a pop, and we can go home, take a shower, and enjoy this one.
Once again, oh no, Coe fakes it, keeps it himself, Travis Coe in for the touchdown, and that'll seal it for the Foxes. 19-yard scamper by number 11, Travis Coe, and you can put this one in the books. How appropriate that this guy would win it.
Great description, that was definitely a scamper. He ran the belly play up inside and really completely fooled the Darlington defense and ran through a hole so big.
You know, this is a good job by his running backs, too, to be able to know when he's going to pull that ball back out, because a lot of times they would have a tendency to clamp down on that ball. A great rapport between running back and quarterback. This team is just very, very impressive. The offense is really just a machine. They had a challenge given to them. Darlington mounts a comeback, but Hartsville hangs in there, and they show that they still have something left. It is now 28-13, the Red Foxes on top of the Falcons.
Good credit, bad credit, we can help at Rent-A-Center, the largest rent-to-own center in the world, where you can rent name-brand appliances, name-brand furniture, big-screen TVs, VCRs, and more, all at low weekly or monthly rates with no down payment. We'll even deliver it to you for free. Rent real diamond and gold bridal jewelry with no credit check and no deposit. We're also the only company in town that rents pagers. If you need it, come to Rent-A-Center for no hassles and great service. Located in the Hallmark Shopping Center on South Irby Street in Florence.
Elko Products Company, founded in 1899 in Hartsville, South Carolina. A world leader in package manufacturing, a world leader in recycling, a world leader in industrial safety. 17,000 team members providing customer satisfaction through excellence for more than 250 locations in 24 countries. Sunoco Products Company, packaging around the corner, around the world. Proud to call South Carolina home.
Take but a minute, the last drive.
She don't know who she missed.
Put some numbers on the board. Hudson still has Samuels and Mustafa and standing behind him.
The pass complete to Scott. Oh, and it's a shoestring tackle. Scott was trying to break away, but Marcus Scott comes up with a tackle there, a saving
tackle.
They
tried Brad Lawson on him in the last series, and Brad couldn't do too much of a job on him. Now they're going to move Marcus Scott over on Brian Scott. Got to match up a little athleticism over there.
Scott tackles Scott. 55 seconds and counting. Hudson goes down.
Chucky.
And look who's there, Chucky Wilson. Well, this is not a telling stat. 230 yards rushing for Hartsville, 13 for Darlington. Ouch.
Yeah, the offensive line for Hartsville has controlled the line of scrimmage. That's going to be the key to this game. And until Gerald Harrison can establish a running game with this young team, he's got, it's going to, he's really going to. Hartsville, with the physical talent up front, can really go after Huston. And with his young offensive line, it's going to make life miserable for him. So there's a kind of a hand-in-hand thing going here. If he can establish the run, it'll open up his outside game. Mentioned right quickly, Rashawn Travis has really been a non-factor in this game on the offensive side of the ball.
Right. Well, keep in mind, when this game ends, hang with us, folks, because we'll have interview with Lewis Leinberger, the head coach of the Hartsville Red Foxes, and we'll also try to talk with Travis Coe, the quarterback, who has just been absolutely phenomenal here tonight. spark that makes the engine go.
And hang on for Terry's two-minute sprint coming up after the game.
There's Hudson firing away, and that one goes awry. Complete. That'll stop the clock at 39 seconds.
They've moved Timko over and covering up Travis, Rashawn Travis on the outside there, and has really done a good job of defending him in the last minute of this ball game.
Once again, Hudson going to the air.
He's thrown the ball behind Travis twice in a row, and Travis is completely frustrated, as I'm sure Orlando is also. And that's going to put it all on one play now for Darlington.
Crowd beginning to file out of Kellytown Stadium, but what a game it was for the hometown fans. Hartsville flexing its muscles. Hudson back to pass, scrambling to his left. He's going to tuck it in and run. Thinks about cutting back, but it is knocked out of bounds at the 40-yard line. Clock stops, 25 seconds to go.
And believe it or not, he's going to be just short of a first down. He was only about a foot short of a first down. They're going to have to bring the chains all the way from the other side of the field. The young man just didn't quite know where he was in the field. If he'd have known what he needed for a first down, he probably could have gotten it because he ducked out of bounds early. That's the first time we've seen the Hartsville defense break down in coverage that's allowed Orlando Hudson to pick up some yardage. So it's going to be a long walk across the field for the chain guys. Hubba hubba, guys.
He needed 15. Somebody got about 14 and 6 inches, I think. Well, we got a camera right on it. We'll see if he indeed got that first down.
I think he's going to be about 6 inches to a foot short. Terry, you might want to catch a ride with these coaches from Hartsville heading down to the field now. They just made their move. But this one's over. You can put it in the books. 26 seconds to go in the game. Hartsville's up 28-13. And Hartsville's going to be content just bringing in, staying with the offensive starters. Now there's a few more new faces in there for Coach Lewis Lineberger, number 70. Now, Leon Brown's the starter, so they got all their horses in there. They're going to finish it up strong.
Good look at Coach Lineberger on the sidelines. Got to be happy with both the offense and defensive play tonight. Maybe just the he'll work on the defensive
little bit of pass,
coverage
a little bit. Pass defense,
but,
little corner
than
cover.
That, flawless. And the clock continues to run down. 20 seconds and counting, and that'll do it as time runs down. Here at Kellytown Stadium, the final score, Hartsville goes to 2-0. They hand the Darlington Falcons the first loss in school history.
Ever.
They go to 1-1. 28-13, your final score. Back with some post-game interviews right after this.
Jerry.
1, 2, 3, thank you. Hey, can you guys hurry up? I'm losing valuable tanning time.
Calm down, man. At this beach, sun isn't the only objective.
I'm ready to be rescued.
Have you guys ever seen female lifeguards look so good?
They're the best.
Tell me about it, dude. What a life. We get to go to the beach
5 times a week.
Turn on the heat 5 times a week. Baywatch.
Coming this fall to TV 21.
Good credit, bad credit, we can help at Rent-A-Center, the largest rent-to-own center in the world, where you can rent name-brand appliances, name-brand furniture, big-screen TVs, VCRs, and more, all at low weekly or monthly rates with no down payment. We'll even deliver it to you for free. Rent real diamond and gold bridal jewelry with no credit check and no deposit. We're also the only company in town that rents pagers. If you need it, come to Rent-A-Center for no hassles and great service. Located in the Hallmark Shopping Center on South Irby Street in Florence.
She don't know who she messing with.
Here's your chance to see the show that everyone's been talking about. Gullah Productions presents A Joyful Sound, backed by overwhelming demand for 2 big shows, September 2nd and 3rd, Saturday at 7 p.m. and Sunday at 6 p.m. at the Myrtle Beach High School Auditorium. It's the show the Sun News calls a welcome addition to the Myrtle Beach area. Get your tickets now at these locations or charge by phone at 448-4566. A Joyful Sound. If you've seen it once, you've got to see it again.
Elko Products Company, founded in 1899 in Hartsville, South Carolina. A world leader in package manufacturing, a world leader in recycling, a world leader in industrial safety. 17,000 team members providing customer satisfaction through excellence from more than 250 locations in 24 countries. Sonoco Products Company, packaging around the corner, around the world. Proud to call South Carolina home.
And welcome back to Kellytown Stadium, where the home team, the Hartsville Red Foxes, are victorious for the second time this season. And joining us now live here on the field is Coach Lewis Leinberger. And Lewis, boy, you must be very proud of that offensive machine, just a juggernaut tonight, and Travis just really running that offense to perfection.
Well, Travis has a lot of experience, and he ran the offense extremely well. We were counting on having a good offensive team this year, and last week we were a little disappointed. This week I think we made up for it. Our offense came through, our defense played extremely hard, and we feel like we're getting better every day, and hopefully we'll continue to do so.
Defensively, Coach, your defense really did a good job of taking Orlando Hudson and Darlington out of their pass offense. Second half, a little shaky. What were some of the problems you were experiencing in the second half?
I think once we got up, we let up a little bit, and we weren't getting in the right defense a couple of times. Our defensive backs played hard, and we just made some mistakes, but when it counted, we made some big plays.
Well, Coach, congratulations. You moved to 2-0, and we look for you later on down the road. Maybe we can get another state championship out of the Red Foxes this year. We'll have to wait and see, huh?
Well, this is a great win for us, but we still got a long way to go before we get there.
Well, you're on the right track, indeed. Thank you once again for joining us, and good luck down the road. Well, Lane, we had a good one here. It started out, looked to be Hartsville was going to blow them out, but Darlington showing some resilience and came back, tried to make a game of it, but Hartsville just too much.
I think you're seeing a difference in talent level. Lamar last week for Darlington's a step down. They really tried to establish a running game. Coming out against Hartsville, you got to hope if you can move the ball on a team like this, you're going to be very successful. No go. I mean, Hartsville's defense said, you're not going to be able to run the ball against us. So they were forced to pass. And Hudson and his receivers just really couldn't click until that one or two series late in the game. But it was a good game, turned out. And Darlington's got something to build on here.
They certainly do. 28-13 is your final score here from Hartsville. Hartsville victorious over Darlington, the first loss in school history. They move to 1-1. The Red Foxes move to 2-0. The game of the week next week moves to Scotland County, Marlborough County, and Scotland County. We look forward to bringing you that ball game, of course, live kickoff beginning at 8 o'clock. For Lane Harris, I'm Terry Gern saying thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next week on the WWMB Football Game of the Week. Good night, everyone.